Hey, let's start the show.
It's December 19th, 2013. Welcome to This Is Only a Test, the official podcast of tested.com. Hello, everyone. We're back. We're back on the radio waves, on the podcast waves. I'm Norm, hosting this week for This Is Only a Test, possibly the last podcast we'll have this year. Will has been out on vacation. That's why we didn't have a podcast last week, and Jerry and I were down in L.A. But quickly, I wanted to introduce our guests. We have the A-plus team. It's not a B team. Wes Fenland's sitting immediately to my left.
Hello.
And Jeremy Williams, my favorite guest. To Wes's left.
Thanks, Norm.
Hi. I'm sure Wes will not take that personally.
Wes is not a guest. Wes is
a member of the family.
Yeah, Wes is the closer.
I hope that intro music sounded better to your listeners than it did to me.
I'm sure it did not.
I thought it sounded great. I don't know.
It sounded very lo-fi. I'll have to apologize in advance. We're bootstrapping our podcast technology this week because I'm sitting literally on a mess of snaking cables, and I feel like if I twist this chair a little too much, a cable is going to pop off and like everything on this mixer is going to fall apart. Basically, this is not our normal setup. Because Will's out, we're bootstrapping a bunch of stuff.
Will being gone really just makes me wish that I got to sit here with like an Arnold Schwarzenegger soundboard and just play annoying sound clips throughout the whole podcast.
You know, that's great that you mentioned soundboards, because we're going to jump to news right now. We have lots to talk about. We're going to go through some quick news over the past 2 weeks, but it is the last podcast of the year. It's the end of the year, which I don't know how that happened so quickly. It's already 19th of December. It's already Thursday, and it's already December. We're like a week and a half away from New Year's, less than a week away from Christmas. But we're going to talk about some end of the year stuff, talk about stuff that's on the site, some upcoming projects, talk about CES and all that fun stuff. But soundboards. Have you guys played with soundboards? I'm using a soundboard right now on this computer.
Yeah, man. Very last decade. That's awesome.
Well, physical soundboards.
No. Oh, what are you talking about?
Well, there were physical soundboards, like you
actually hardwire real buttons
to audio clips. But software soundboards, like flash soundboards, yeah. Like the one that Wes mentioned,
very
the Schwarzenegger one.
E-Bombs World, Newsgrounds.
Oh, yeah. Newgrounds.
I don't know who pioneered the internet soundboard.
It was like the first viral audio clip. Maybe not the first, but one of the early viral audio clips was the famous Arnold Schwarzenegger soundboard, in which someone prank called Dell Support, I think it was.
Really?
And did a whole conversation with sound clips from Terminator, Terminator 2, from Kindergarten Cop.
Yep.
You know, who's your daddy? What does he do?
Mm-hmm. Get to the chopper.
No Predator. I don't think there
really?
Was any Predator.
What's
in
the
in
point
that.
Without Get to the Chopper?
The point was that it was calling Dell Tech Support, and so the payoff was, I'm a learning computer. That line, you know, I'm a neural net processor, learning computer. But soundboards have been flipped the other way around, and last week, Time Magazine issued a report about a robot telemarketer. And Wes, you wrote a story about this. So what's the deal with this robot telemarketer?
So the robot telemarketer is probably not a robot, but we don't know 100%. But the idea is this Time bureau chief got called by a robot talking about insurance. First of all, that's a really bad person to target for with your like mysterious robot voice, is someone who heads up a news magazine. Anyway, you get called and realize that this person calling them, trying to sell them insurance, sounds very nice and human, except for the way in which their responses are doled out is kind of robotic. And then so they started asking questions like, what's the vegetable in tomato soup? And it kind of paused for a second and then said, I'm sorry, I don't understand the question. And then they'd ask it some other stuff and it would say, I think we're having some interference. Can you repeat the question? and then hung up. So they kept calling this number back and testing it with all these questions saying, please just tell me that you're a person. And it would go, ha ha ha, of course there's a real person on the other end of this line, and never say what they wanted.
He wanted her to say, I am not a robot.
Yeah.
And she refused to say that.
And so it was the same voice every time?
The same voice. Sounds like a very nice lady. But
many variants of I'm a real person.
Yeah, it had two or three different responses for, of course I'm a real person, I am not a robot, but never exactly the phrasing that they asked it to say.
When I read your story on this, I thought it was speech synthesis. So I was actually really excited that somebody invented, you know, the Turing game for speech synthesis where you couldn't tell. And it was just absolutely...
You thought there was a person typing on a computer and then outputting as opposed to like the... something that's,
no, I thought it was like, hello, Google, or whatever it is. Okay, Google. You know, I thought it was just like actually like interactive computer.
Oh, okay.
Speech recognition. Right. Speech
so not
that's what I think of as
not
robot.
Typing to voice.
Right.
Which was a really old technology that worked really poorly. And something like Siri uses voice samples, just thousands and thousands of samples of an actress or an actor talking like voicing all the phonemes, everything, all the intonations or every type of words. I mean, if you can tap into your GPS, even your a GPS system, and I've done this accidentally, like using a Bluetooth cable or something, I can get my car to recite every command in order that it knows, like turn left 50 meters, and like 50, 10. And it's just weird. It's like hundreds of commands just for GPS. And we've all interacted with robot telemarketer or robot answering machines
when you call
tech support
or something.
Yeah. And those are not pretending to be human at all, but this is flipping it around and a robot calling someone pretending to be a human.
So Alexis Madrigal at The Atlantic did a really good investigation into this, because his theory, and if you think about it, it makes sense. Like, if this was a robot doing this voice and being this responsive and calling out to people instead of having calls come in, it's really, really good. It's better than any, like, robotic voice software that anyone has ever seen. It's
when you say robot, you mean completely autonomous.
Autonomous.
Right. Better than Siri. Like, so he started investigating it, and his deduction based on talking to the kind of companies that make like robotic calling software is that nobody has developed anything this advanced. Even talked to, I think, Nuance, who was the only, like a few other companies were like, well, if anybody could do it, it was probably Nuance. And he called them and they're like, that's not ours.
Well, you think about the database of just the whole, the parts of the system you would need to synthesize a conversation Turing machine, like you said, Jeremy, because Turing machine, we haven't even passed the point where we can convince typers, not even with voice, that the person on the other line is real and so simulate a conversation. I mean, to some extent, the robot can direct the conversation, and there are some outs, like the interference thing. But
the key is that it was able to respond way too quickly to people's questions and what they said, to the point that like the natural language recognition processing that would have to take place to process that fast enough just doesn't exist yet.
Or so, wouldn't be worth for a telemarketer.
So it is just a soundboard is the theory.
So his theory is it's this outgoing voice recording software could not possibly be capable of this. And it's somebody basically with a soundboard listening to responses, a human listening to responses and then pressing buttons or, you know, triggering software responses based on what people are saying.
Which in itself is interesting, because that is a phenomenon that could only exist in our society, where there has been backlash against overseas telemarketers and overseas call centers. And the idea that Alexis Madrigal in The Atlantic put out is that it's someone that knows English, can maybe speak English, and definitely understand English, but maybe can't speak English in the same voice that someone in the U.S. would want to hear or expect to hear, and so they have to hide behind the robot voice. What I'm going to do right now is we actually have the conversation, one of the time conversation, recorded conversations queued up, and I'm going to play. It's only about 2 minutes long. We're just going to sit and listen to it and see if you out there, if you haven't heard it yet, if you can, at what point do you realize that it's a robot, or how does it come off to you?
Hi, I'm good. How are you?
Well, I'm calling about an online request you once made about health insurance coverage.
Okay.
I work with all major companies and compare
Hey, are you a robot?
What? No, I am a real person. Maybe we have a bad connection. I'm sorry about that.
Oh, that's crazy. I see you just sound so much like a robot.
I am a real person. Maybe we have a bad connection. I'm sorry about that.
Will you tell me you're not a robot? Just say I'm not a robot, please.
I am a real person.
I mean, I believe you, but will you just say I'm not a robot? It'll make me feel better to hear you say it.
There is a live person here.
But I know there is. It would just make me feel so much better to hear you say, I am not a robot.
What?
If you could say the words, I'm not a robot, it would really mean a lot to me.
I am a real person. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can hear you fine. I just want to hear you say, I am not a robot.
Yes, I'm a real person.
Right, but will you say I'm not a robot?
Health Enrollment Center? Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Let me ask you a couple of questions. Are you currently on Medicare?
No, I'm not.
Okay.
But now let me ask you a question.
Medicaid or looking for Medicaid?
We'll go, you ask me a question, then I'll ask you a question. How about that?
Sure.
Okay, are you a robot?
No.
Will you say I'm not a robot?
It's interesting, some of her voice, some of the words that she says, she almost sounds perturbed, you know, that they have those samples. Where
yeah,
she,
when she says no.
Right, she says no.
And I think we're,
okay.
I think that's us,
I don't know,
putting that in the conversation.
Maybe.
One of them definitely had like a lilt to it, or one of the early words where she said like, I'm sorry you think that, or something. She sounded a little sad.
Why so many variations of I'm not a robot?
And the variations are all the same structure. It's laugh,
yeah.
I'm a real person, and then is there something wrong with the call? There's maybe some interference.
The laugh, I think, format is the biggest giveaway and also the creepiest part about it, with the 2 second pause and then the laugh clip that yeah. lasts 1 second.
And there are a couple moments in there where the audio just cuts off, or comes in abruptly, or where yeah. it's like there's like some mixing going on almost on the side of the telemarketer.
Like if you ever use a soundboard, if they have 7 variations of I'm not a robot, he probably has 200 buttons and he's trying to find the right one. You know, he's trying to find, no, I used laugh one already, I must click laugh two.
It's like that alien that Pixar short.
Yeah, who's right.
Learning, right?
Yeah, with
it's like
1,000
pushing
controls.
All the buttons.
Exactly.
Right. To me, it also calls to mind the thought experiments, the Chinese box thought experiment.
What's that?
I've talked about this on the podcast before. It's a cognitive science theory by this professor named in Berkeley named Searle, John Searle. And he was actually the guy that, have you seen the movie Sunshine?
Yeah, well, just half of it.
just the first half, right? There's a guy named Searle in that, and he was named after this professor of philosophy and cognitive science. And he came up with this thought experiment of it's basically disproving hard AI and saying that AI can't have consciousness. And the idea is if there's a robot that sat inside a box, or a person sat inside a box and received a card through the box, and with that card matched up in a card catalog the appropriate response in a different language, like received in a piece of a sentence in Chinese and then found the corresponding response and then output it yep. and passed the Turing test that way, would the person inside that box understand Chinese? Could you say that he understood Chinese? And the idea is that no, you wouldn't, because he's just matching responses like AI would. And so to tie it to this, it feels like that it's like, you know, cue response, and it's not so much AI that's being tested here, it's like English proficiency and the English dialect.
So my favorite part of this story is the time reporters kept calling back to this number, and eventually they didn't get Samantha West, the robot or voice board or whatever. They got this guy who worked for Premier Health Plans, which was this insurance company.
Okay.
And he basically said, I don't know for sure if this is this was one of our numbers, which doesn't make sense to me since they called it.
The same number.
I'm not sure exactly how that works. And he said, I'll check to see if this is a real employee at the company, but it'll take me a couple days. In the meantime, if you're going to publish this, I want you guys to publish the name of our company and our our number and stuff in there so we get something out of it. And Tom was like, yeah, sure, because they wanted to report on anyway. And then the update at the end of the story is, as of December 11th, one day after this story published, the phone number listed above was no longer answered by Samantha West. Rather, it diverted callers to a busy signal. Also, the website, premierhealthagency.com, had been taken offline. So one day before, this guy's like, yeah, put our website and our name out there, and now their website doesn't exist anymore.
Here's an idea. What if Time Magazine has played into a brilliant viral marketing strategy for Spike Jonze's Her?
Oh.
Just putting that out there.
That would be pretty cool.
Putting that out there.
That's a brilliant connection. I thought you were just going to say some viral campaign, you know, something like Horsey Books, but Her. Oh.
That would be the best viral advertising for a movie, I think, ever.
Well, no one's falling in love with Samantha West yet. I think more people are falling in love with the Kindle Fire HDX advertisement woman.
Taking it offline Amy. Would be a mistake because it would not give enough people the opportunity to talk to Samantha
West. Is that movie
West.
Out yet?
Her?
This weekend, right?
This weekend?
Maybe not. I saw reviews.
I've heard only good things.
Yeah. I know it's had early releases. It might be like officially wide release this weekend.
It could be Joaquin Phoenix as finally he gets his Oscar. He was so disappointed when he didn't get it in The Master.
Yeah, it came out yesterday.
Oh.
He was really good in The Master.
You know, there's also a rumor that he might play Lex Luthor in the new Superman-Batman movie.
That'd be good. I approve.
I think that would be good. I'm afraid that he would revert back to his, like, gladiator role. His spoiled, angry...
He was so young in that.
He was very young in that.
I think he would be very different.
Since then, he's had Signs. He's been in Signs. He was in Signs since then.
Unfortunately.
Was he also in The Village?
You might be right. I never saw that. I went one past Unbreakable and saw Signs, but didn't see The Village or The Happening or Lady in the Water. Anyway, that was just an excuse so I could go to make it just like a real podcast that we normally do. Last Friday, Valve released Steam OS beta. I have not installed it yet.
Video games on Linux.
That's right.
Exciting, sort of.
And also shipped out the 300 prototype Steam boxes, which apparently iFixit was able to get one of.
What?
300.
Yeah. Wow.
Like someone sent it to them, someone got it, and then they did a teardown, and there's a great disassembly on their site today, which is awesome.
Do you know if that 300 included ones they sent to developers as well?
Okay. No, this is just for the beta program.
I know like Double Fine got one. And
yeah.
I'm sure a lot of bigger independent developers probably got them.
I mean, Valve on their blog posted a photo of the assembly of these machines, and it looked like a big assembly warehouse where they were putting them together. But nothing too remarkable about these PCs. They are just gaming PCs. It came in a really nice wooden crate, had some Valve-esque, humor and decals on them, instruction manual. The big thing, of course, is the controller, which is a prototype controller, USB. It's plugged in, it's wired, and doesn't have, I believe, the screen, right?
Right.
In the center. I don't know the people who got the 300 prototypes, if they're obligated to send those back, the controllers at least, because that's the big, like, that's really rare for prototype hardware to go out to the public like this, even though, the software isn't finalized either. But people have installed SteamOS, and you can run it. You need an NVIDIA card to run it.
Which will play into, would you need an NVIDIA card eventually for their streaming technology?
Depends how they're doing it. The NVIDIA 7 series cards have the built-in encoder.
So NVIDIA has their own streaming solution that they're working on, and Valve hasn't really talked too much about how theirs is going to work, right?
They haven't. But I don't think it's that difficult to tap into that. Or just use more processing power to compensate on the side. But this isn't the streaming box, though. This is the receiving box.
Right, but it could like, theoretically, I mean, it should be able to handle streaming just like...
Streaming out, also.
Right.
Like, what we don't know is what that low-end $100, $150 box looks like and how that's going to work. And Valve is going to be at CES, so we'll have to bug them about it there and figure it out. But, I mean, the PC they sent out... They said it was a variety of specs. The one that iFixit tore down was a 780 GTX. Micro ITX motherboard had a riser card so that it fit into that case. It did have, a third-party cooler and specced out. It was about a $1,300 machine.
Each case is unique, you know. There's
really?
There's 300 drilled holes in the side of it, and everybody's case has a large hole, but every hole, you know, everybody's hole is a different one. So if you
it's a very Mr. Rogers, everyone's special.
If you see photos, like Valve can tell.
That's their watermark?
Whose it is.
Okay.
I read that on Reddit, so it must be true.
It must be true. Did you see that Bill Gates gave out a Reddit gift?
Yeah.
That was awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
Bill Gates is, and he had a great photo too. He held out the cow, the plush cow. So Reddit does Secret Santa every year in their massive online community. And apparently someone in Bill Gates' marketing team or business team.
It could have been him. I'm just saying, the guy's retired.
He did the AMA himself when he did one of those. And
yes, but the physical like pack, I want to believe that he like picked out the cow.
I believe.
And picked out the book. And then I'm sure you probably signed the card, but more likely he was doing a million other things in his day. And then one of his assistants said, okay, here, you need to sign this and take this picture by this tree. And I mean,
don't Grinch out, man.
I've hung around people who've had to do those things, and they work on a schedule. Everyone's very busy.
Has anybody seen SteamOS? Does it look like
big
TV mode?
Big TV, yeah.
All right.
And again, there's none of that streaming functionality that I know of right now. So really, it's just to get it working on Linux and get people plugging into their TVs. We'll be building one in the new year, so cool. we'll be testing it out. But I think we want to wait till there's more software and have something to show, because fumbling through SteamOS with nothing to show isn't all that interesting.
It would be cool if you could buy one of those prototype controllers.
Yeah.
You know?
I know. I mean, early next year, we're hoping. But I think that's the thing that everyone's really interested in. The box itself
is controller. Less
interesting. The controller. Yeah, and whether it makes sense. I mean, there's always keyboard and mouse. Also, late last week, it was kind of random news, like late Friday night, this news dropped, New York Times reported that Google has bought Boston Dynamics.
Yeah.
And that's the Boston Dynamics is a robotics company.
Did they say how much they paid for it?
No, absolutely not. But it's a research firm that we actually saw the CEO of the company talk at the Engadget Expand event earlier this year. And he had some really cool things, like really cool ideas about, you know, the things they're doing are to mimic animal movement and just figuring out what about animal gait and the mechanics of movement can apply to robotics. And that's why they do things like the Big Dog and the Atlas robot. Most of the stuff they do is right now through government contracts, DARPA contracts. So research and how do you get, you know, all-terrain type vehicles and robots to carry heavy loads in terrain. But why did Google buy Boston Dynamics?
I just think you should explain for some of your listeners who haven't seen these videos or made the connection.
I doubt that
many have
not. Dog.
Big Dog.
They're the ones that make that amazing robot dog that can carry
100
pounds, a mule, and can run 30 miles an hour.
No. They're all separate robots.
That one can't go that fast?
No. So they have a robot that's the big dog, that's the mule, that's the load-carrying one, and it can follow a soldier. So they've tested in the field on the hills, and it can recognize the leader and do a follow leader and navigate through paths, so over trees and stuff. And has the amazing thing, it has a stabilization system. So the big viral video was that, you know, you kick the side of the big dog,
right,
and it stabilizes itself like a real animal. It doesn't, like, scream, but you kind of hear it, like, screech a little bit. It's really, really creepy.
It sounds like some of these run on lawnmower motors. Like, they rev them up, right? They have real powerful engines in there.
They have real, like, high torque motors in there,
yeah.
But low battery life. So a lot of that stuff is also tested in-house. So the one that can run real fast, the Cheetah one, and the one they had showed in...
The Cheetah.
That's a Transformers.
Are you not thinking about Cheetara?
No.
Thundercats?
No. No, the Transformers Maximal.
I might not have gotten that far in Beast Wars.
It was Beast Machines.
Right, that was like a season 3 thing or something.
No, it was switched over.
If it's not Gen 1, I'm not in the conversation.
there's a Cheetah robot that runs, I think, like 40 miles per hour, and that one is tethered for power.
Okay.
And then there was a demo of one running, a bigger big dog-like robot running in a parking lot, and
yeah,
did some like maneuvers where it could like hard brake and then turn around.
I thought that was the 30 mile an hour one.
I don't think that was that fast.
No.
And then they have the Atlas humanoid robot, which can walk on a treadmill and overcome some obstacles as well. But again, I ask, why did Google buy Boston Dynamics? So it's one of the seven companies that they bought to launch Andy Rubin's project. It's like, Andy Rubin, Android guy, I want to build Androids. Phones are no longer interesting. Google wanted to keep him, and then...
Clearly, they want to go big on robots, and...
What do robots...
You can't go much bigger than Boston Dynamics.
Right, but what do robots... What can robots do that would benefit Google's master plan? Okay, Google wants data. So a lot of speculation is that they're going to use these robots to do street view and data collection in places that vehicles and humans can't reach, so mountain climbing. Some people speculated that these robots may be used for delivery and be an alternative to, for example, aerial drone delivery.
I mean, broad picture, if they just buy the best robot companies they can get and they have the most advanced robotics, you know, development on the planet, they are going to get the business that, you know, with everybody else who wants,
but they're not
to,
in the business of making
robots, or
they're not in the business of
government contracts.
Making, but they're not, and they've said they're not in the business of government contracts. And it doesn't really make sense for Google to be in the business of government contracts.
I think
research.
This is like Google thinks in terms of moonshots, right? They're 10x philosophies of how can we do something that is beyond expectations. And but
with a goal.
Yeah,
there's got to be a purpose.
No, absolutely. I think that they're. I could be wrong, but I imagine that they might be trying to do AI. They might be trying to make androids.
Well, they are doing AI. They've said that the Star Trek computer is their ultimate goal.
I mean, the movie.
Oh, okay. Where, androids.
You know, yeah.
But humanoid robots, and that's not what Boston Dynamics wants to do thinks it's a smart thing to do. Like a spider robot can be infinitely more maneuverable and durable and versatile than a humanoid robot.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's the military stuff and the rock climbing and all that seems like it could be handled by drones, you know. It seems like a lot of the
aerial drones.
Yeah,
mean,
the street view, the satellite stuff seems like it should be handled in the air, but I don't know. It seems like, you know, if they're trying to do self-driving cars, why not make autonomous robots?
Autonomous, I think tying it to autonomous cars is probably the best bet. And there was also the speculation that they would be using it to improve robotics manufacturing. Because right now, even though industrial robots are used for assembly of vehicles and electronics, a lot of the fine work is done by hand. And that's very expensive. So if they can automate that and get rid of more jobs, then... You know, maybe that's one direction they're going to go in. But I think the autonomous car and the new, like, think about the new normal. Like, 10, 15 years from now, we'll get autonomous cars on the road. And that we can all see the benefits easily of autonomous cars in terms of easing traffic, optimizing traffic to get rid of congestion, and also car sharing. So a car picks you up, drops you off, and then go pick someone up. It's automated Uber, basically. And there's no cars are always in optimal circulation. It's like, you know, first in, first out. You're not going to get tons of cars parked on the freeway or the streets. And then if you can think one step further and how that would apply to robots, we're all riding robot horses and I don't know.
I think if you just...
Elderly people are being carried by their robots.
Just think of Google.com, the search engine, and how that is the de facto search engine that you go to when you want to find something. If in 20 years, because of the things they've developed and the companies they've bought, if the first thing you think of when you think of, I want to buy a robot or have robots for these purposes, if Google
but
is...
Google's not a hardware company. They sell hardware to promote their software and their ad platforms because they make money from ads.
But if they have the technology that people want for robots that are used for saving people, you know, in earthquake situations or self-driving cars or whatever, even if it's just them like licensing technology and not building those robots, that still makes them super powerful and super rich.
I guess it's also what it ties into what Jeff Bezos said when he talked about Amazon drones and, you know, the gut response with, and I don't know if we even talked about Amazon drones in the podcast. Did we?
It was such a Black Friday just stunt.
Yes, a big marketing stunt to get people on Amazon.com, one of the most valuable pages on the internet.
And I'm sure it worked really, really well.
Oh, yeah. But it totally made sense when he said they want to explore the idea of drone delivery because they don't want someone to do it better than them and make them obsolete, because every company, every platform will eventually go by the wayside. Someone smarter, someone more nimble. You know, the hurdles that companies overcome now with their technologies won't be hurdles anymore, and some other company will take on new challenges. And so maybe Google's thinking that way. I think we're all still waiting for the autonomous car.
They've got a lot of money to waste on, you know, really amazing ideas that might not go anywhere.
I'm glad they're spending the money on interesting ideas, as long as they aren't evil, I guess.
Yeah.
It doesn't need to be said. Have you guys checked out Google location history?
I did a little bit when you tweeted it last night.
Apparently, it's not that new. It's been around. It just resurfaced. I think TechCrunch did a story about it yesterday. But it's been around for a long time. It was tied into Google Latitude, but when they kind of brushed Latitude aside, because they were, and this is interesting. Google over the past 3 years or so has been consolidating a lot of its products and services. So things that just didn't pan out have been shuffled away.
Or things that people loved, like Google Reader.
That didn't fall into their big plans for money-making. But Google location history, if you go to like maps.google.com/location history and you use something like an Android phone and have location tracking turned on, you will be able to see minute by minute almost where your phone has been and where you have been. By extension. And so you can say, and it's kind of creepy because having switched to Android this year, I can follow this. It's weird because I have I'm juggling multiple Android phones and they all have GPS turned on.
Is this data in the cloud already, or is it extracting data from your phone when you go there?
No, it's not extracting from the phone. It's data that Google already has and tied to your Google account. So everyone sees it a little differently. But if you don't disable your services, you can go back and retrace your steps for months, minute by minute at a time. I can say that, you know, last Friday, I can look at the map and it shows a line from San Francisco to LA, from where I was in LA. And it's both scary, but also really useful, because I totally find myself not remembering what I did 2 weeks ago or a month ago. And I have to often, I rely on Google Calendar as my diary. Almost like I look at Google Calendar and look at, okay, where was I on that Thursday in October? I have no idea. And in Google Calendar, oh, okay, there was at the vet that day, so I went to that thing. And with location history, you can track and see not only where you were on that day, but like where your traffic, what exact location within the city you were.
And it doesn't necessarily just go for Android either. Like I have the Google Now app on iOS,
right.
And even though I feel like I might have had location services disabled for a while, but because it says in the app, this definitely will not impact your battery life, and it actually did. But I think I turned it back on with iOS 7, and it tracks my location too.
Just in the background.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. So like I'm looking at last week and see where I went around the city.
So this is kind of like Find My iPhone, but it's Find My iPhone with a timeline.
Yeah, find where my iPhone has been or where my Android phone has been. There's also a real clear button to delete all history, which is nice. And if you trust Google to actually have that history deleted, because I'm sure there's no undo. I'm hesitant. I don't want to delete it. As creeped out and weirded out as I am that this history is there, it's a little novel.
Give in to the Google.
And I know that if I get rid of it, it's not going to be there. And I kind of want, it's like my memory.
I'd keep it.
Is there.
I don't have anything, but I don't use those apps, but I like the idea.
If you're not worried about someone hunting you down and murdering you, you know, it's probably not too dangerous.
Yep. So because I have multiple devices, it doesn't actually show one linear path. It shows this like star pattern, because it's always thinking that I'm both, you know, outside the city and back at home at the same time, because I have multiple phones pinging the location server at the same time. So it doesn't really work for me.
It'd be fun if you could create an animation throughout time, so you could hit play and watch a day go by in the course of like a minute.
And also then tie it to Google Street View.
Oh.
So you're like reliving, like it's like dry, you know, you're like reliving that car. It's like that Google had that that viral video they tried to promote where someone had a virtual road trip of across America and set up Google Street View and on projectors in their living room. I was at a screening, this movie screening earlier this week, called Lost Landscapes of San Francisco. It's a guy, Rick Prelinger, who runs the Prelinger Archives. He was showing old footage of San Francisco.
From the 1920s?
All through the 20th century, as early as 1920s and up to like the 60s and 70s. And some of the coolest footage was, there's some traffic footage, stock footage from movies. So, you know, outtakes, movie studios would come into San Francisco and shoot cars driving, shoot out of the back of a car. And this would be for the rear projection, for when you have conversations in cars, and they would show, but it was just the raw footage of those scenes, without, you know, the silhouettes of the people.
So you don't have Jimmy Stewart sitting in the fake car.
Nope. And it's
with
just
big steering wheel,
but and it would be minutes of this footage. And it was fascinating. It was like Google Street View for the 1940s in San Francisco.
A lot lower traffic then, probably.
A lot more people in the streets. People
just walking across the street.
Yeah.
Yeah. When were jaywalking laws enacted?
I don't know. I'm sure Ralph Nader had something to do with that. That was more probably the seatbelts. Did you guys see that Apple ad that came out this week?
Home run.
I had a feeling you'd say that. You had to take the spot of our resident Apple enthusiast.
Do you disagree?
I think it's a compelling ad. For people who haven't seen it, Apple released a new holiday ad for the iPhone 5S, and it's called Misunderstood, and it tells the story, and it really is a story of a family vacation to visit, you know, the grandparents or something, somewhere, you know, East Coast in the snow, and there's this kid who looks a little emo, he's staring at his phone all day, and not paying attention to anyone, and at the end, it
turns
out...
What's he doing? Is he texting his girlfriend?
Yeah,
is he just
playing games?
He's
not being very social.
Right, is he on Twitter?
Yeah. And the phone's just illuminating his face, and then at the end, it turns out he's shooting video.
The whole commercial, he had been shooting video.
Right, was the idea. Yeah. And plays it over AirPlay, of course, for the family, and then the dad cries, the mom cried to get a big hug, and it turns out he's just misunderstood.
That's right.
And the power of the iPhone really brought that family together with its video and editing capabilities. And that footage that they showed at the end was actually shot with iPhone 5S.
You can tell because he uses a lot of slow-mo.
Does he?
Yeah. You know, he gets the sock being thrown at him.
Apparently someone in Apple advertising or someone in the know reached out to bloggers or told someone else who was in the know. And it was, the word was that it was actually shot with the 5S. But who shot it? Not that kid.
What?
Because there's a little bit of...
Don't ruin this.
I'm going to ruin
you
it for
are
you,
the
Jeremy.
Grinch this
I'm sorry. I'm just keeping it real.
All right.
In the shots where you... And obviously it's a commercial, so all staged. These people are probably not related. The kid shooting, and when you see him shooting the footage, he's shooting in portrait mode. But the footage, when they show it at the end, is all in a landscape mode.
Ah.
So there's a little bit of continuity error there, which I can... It's a minor continuity. I think if he was holding the phone in landscape, or you know, it would have given away the surprise that
perhaps
he was shooting a video. Or,
yep.
But I don't know anyone who edits video in portrait mode either on the iPhone.
Well, you never saw him edit. You only saw him shooting because they had to refer to all those scenes.
Right. He's got a $2,000 MacBook somewhere.
I wanted him to actually edit it on the phone because you can do that.
I'm sure he did. You just didn't see it.
In the fiction of that commercial. And then there's a lot of the other backlash point that people said was that, okay, it totally falls into this trap of him missing the moment because he's still missing those moments. And while he's preserving them on his phone in some way for the family, he's sacrificing that. It comes at the expense of him enjoying the moment.
Hey, there's no dad with a camera that can't relate to that.
That's true.
Right there. We're all in that position.
You know, when your kids do a school play, are you going to record it with your Nokia 41 megapixel camera?
And sacrifice
and
my
have
enjoyment.
To sit back and sacrifice. When was the last time you recorded something that wasn't your kids and actually went and watched it back?
That was not my kids?
That wasn't your kids.
Oh, not very often.
Yeah.
Maybe at the end of the year we do
it
a little
bit. It takes up a lot of space on your phone is what it does.
Yeah. No, the good of the many outweigh the good of the few. You got to sacrifice your enjoyment sometimes.
I think a balance for all things. Take photos. I think it's fine. I don't think video clips are necessary if you're going to a concert.
No.
At all. But one or two photos, you know, keep in your scrapbook, you know, keep your ticket stubs, stuff like that. Let Google know where you are so you can go back and see where you are at that day. Find things to activate your memory. but have the memory to activate in the first place.
It'll be an interesting change from now versus like even when, you know, my parents would shoot, you know, home video or whatever in the late 80s, like early 90s, and how relatively little video they have and how much it costs to get one of those cameras versus, you know, in 40 years when video is like so easy to take. I mean, it's already so easy to take. What is it going to be like to show our kids those home videos? Are they going to give a shit because there's 50 hours of it?
That is a fascinating...
Or is that going to be great to like have that relic and have that much of your life like preserved that you would have totally not remembered because you were two or six or, you know, however.
Well, I think the answer is that algorithms are going to edit those videos for us. And so you don't have to actually spend time piecing them together. And you have the more data and footage you have and the more stuff that's shared, the slideshow, family slideshow of the future is going to be interactive. It's going to be like, you know, hate to say Minority Report, but like diving into those memories, like when he goes back into those scenes and plays back like the 3D projected video clips, it's going to be maybe like that. It actually goes back to that footage I was talking about, this the Lost Landscape stuff, because a lot of that stuff was home movies, and Rick Prelinger's fascination or his area of interest is on home movies and collecting old 16mm, 8mm film from families who were affluent, could afford it. And back when Kodak was... processing that film, they will release books. There are lots of books in the Prelinger Library about teaching families how to shoot home movies. And like, you can shoot home movies. It's really simple. And here's some cinematic techniques, you know, that you could use to make your home movies look nice. And books that you would buy when you got your film processed to make you a better filmmaker. And people really like, it's looking at that footage, it's fascinating. You see so much more than you would in a photo. Just like nuance and faces, even like the outtakes. You know, having the same scene, people, dads getting kids to do things over and over again. There's a great story of like when the moon landing happened and people were on family vacation and, you know, they would have their cameras. Back then you couldn't record the TV. So they recorded the TV
screen,
the home. So you'd have this like family at the motel in the swimming pool and enjoying their vacation, but the moon landing was happening that night. So right after that footage of the swimming pool, it would be the footage of the TV capturing that moon landing. Like, that's incredible.
Yeah. Just to point out the inverse result that we've seen in photographs of video, because as video has gone on the rise, obviously photos have gone down. So in our generation, we have a lot of photos from our childhood, but our kids only have digitals. And, you know, the digital shots.
Basically, you mean physical photos.
Yeah, photographs. So when you look at photographs, a lot of the kids today, they don't have the quality shots that we did when we were kids.
Well, think about old photos today. It's nice to have the photo, but it's even better to have the negative.
Yeah.
And right now we have digital negatives. You have your DNG files.
Yep.
So as long as you keep those DNG files backed up, then that's going to be what in the future people can combine them and alter them and bring them back up and restore them. Speaking of photography and video, do you know that your laptop, we all have MacBooks here, right? Yep.
We do.
Yep. The webcam on your laptop, theoretically, you should know when it's on.
Yes.
And Ars Technica had this story earlier this year about the creepy pervs in the communities who hack into innocent people's laptops and spy on them. And one of the ways that they can try to get away with it is on certain laptops, they can disable the light or just people just don't notice the light and record things without people knowing. But on MacBooks, that's not supposed to happen because it's supposed to be hardwired to, the light is hardwired to the camera. But this might not be the case, at least on 2008 and older MacBooks, as a recent study has discovered. And Wes, you wrote a story about this today?
Yeah, so some guys from Johns Hopkins University kind of did a breakdown of how the old EyeSight cameras worked on MacBook Pros. And I don't think they tested newer ones. It was old MacBook Pros, old iMacs, like everything that had the EyeSight camera. I'm not sure how the technology of the newer webcams relates. I assume it's different because they didn't do this study with those, but there might be a similar way to get around the light. But basically it is hardwired in that when there's a connection in the circuitry between the image processor chip and the little LED. And when the chip is on standby mode, the light is basically told, like, the connection is active and it's like, or the connection is inactive and it says no power and it's just off.
And this is on the board that's
on the board
connecting both the LED and the camera.
And then when the image processor is active, power is going to the LED, it's active, the light's on, the webcam's on. And they figured out a way basically to go into the firmware, and Apple has had an option in the firmware that said, do you want to ignore the standby mode or pay attention to the standby mode? By default, it is pay attention to it. But they wrote some software to basically ignore the standby mode and then ensure that the power going to it is always active. So the light basically stays off while the camera is on, and you can just turn on somebody's webcam, you know, record whatever. You don't even need like root level access to run this software on a computer, and then you can use the webcam without the light coming on. So it's because of that software layer that even though the light is hardwired to this chip, they can basically just say ignore it.
Can we presume that the reason why this isn't possible on newer iMacs is because Apple acknowledged it's a known vulnerability?
So they messaged Apple about this like 6 months ago, I think, or it said August was when they like finished their study. They told them about it. Apple talked to them a little bit, and they wrote a kernel like fix for it basically called EyeSight Defender, which you can download on GitHub. It's free, but they did not. Apple has not like built it into. They didn't do anything about it basically, but it could very well be that same vulnerability does not exist with the newer cameras.
Right.
But that doesn't mean there isn't another vulnerability.
There's always software, firmware at least, that controls the hardware, no matter how things are tied together, unless it's an analog system.
And it's not like these are the only webcams that have issues. I mean, a lot of webcams straight up have an option to not use that LED, or they don't have an LED like that.
Yeah, they call it Logitech webcam specifically. Yep. Where it's just in the local software, desktop software, that flips on the camera, or the camera light when the webcam is on.
You most certainly could hard code it. I mean, it could be a part of the same circuit that powers the camera with unbreakable, you know, right?
Mm.
I assume so.
Yeah.
This was an oversight in Apple's design of the firmware that allows them to go in and hack it. So,
okay. I think the easy solution is to put a sticker. iFix actually sells this EFF-supported sticker. It's a $5 sticker, I think, but it fits over your webcam. It's like a little decal, and you can peel it off when you want to use the camera. I don't remember the last time I used my laptop's camera. Skype occasionally, but I think more often than not, it's not on, so why not a cool sticker? You know what? We can't cut this out of the podcast, but that's cool tested store idea. A little testicles sticker to put on your webcam. What do you guys think about that? Huh? Always thinking.
Would it be leaving sticky gunk on your
No,
your
no,
webcam
no.
Camera?
No, no. Get a good nice decal one that won't leave the gunk. And then remove it. But the one that iFix sells is great, and it supports the EFF, which we also want to support. Oculus. Wow, we're not even through the news yet. Oculus got $75 million in funding.
It's a lot of money.
That's their second round?
I think it's their second round.
That's insane. Yeah. That's so much.
Well, so they got some initial funding, and then they did their Kickstarter after that, right?
Yep.
And now they've got...
No.
The Kickstarter
was way early. That was just... Initially, Palmer Luckey was going to make a hundred for people on the Made to be Seen in 3D forums. And he did the Kickstarter to fund that. And when it took off... That just took on a whole new life.
Wow.
So they did the Kickstarter first, and then they did get some funding since then, but it was relatively, it was like $1 million or a couple million bucks or something like that.
The hype machine is spinning on all cylinders right now. Have you seen those tweets from people who've supposedly seen the new version that they're going to show at CES?
No, wait a minute. There's a new version since the HD ones we've seen?
I think so.
What?
And Mark Rain and Cliffy B and developers.
What are they saying?
I was saying, like, this is going to change the world. I'm sold.
That's Bill
on
Nye.
Board.
Really? Yeah, like a bunch of Epic / former Epic people were at Oculus like last week or a couple weeks ago. Yeah,
Cliffy's been a believer since day one.
Sure. But they're saying that it's not just the resolution thing. They've solved like the headache problem and the latency problem.
Really? They must have solved some of the translation problems.
Yeah, I think I think they've added translation.
Because I know they're working on that.
Yeah.
Wow, that's cool.
The dev kit was such a big hit that it seems like a total no-brainer to me that instead of doing, they're like, yeah, we're going to release the consumer version, you know, 6 months or a year later, they were like, all right, let's
hold off and find it. Yeah, hold off. Make sure it's a home run.
Make this thing really kick ass, because it's been over a year now since the dev kits came out. Wasn't it late 2012 or was it early 2013?
March of 2013. Okay. I was at WonderCon when I got the text from Jeremy that you got your dev kit, and I immediately said, bring it in, we gotta do a video.
And I think the consumer version was initially supposed to come out like by the end of the year or within a year, and I'm guessing it'll probably be like later next year, at least middle of next year by the time.
My feeling is that CS will be pretty big for them.
An unveiling of it, I'm sure.
It'll probably have a lot to do with when the developers are ready, because now that they all have dev kits and they're working on legit projects, they're not going to release the hardware until there's a killer app.
Mm-hmm.
And there are definitely some in the works. So, I mean, the Wing Commander's inspired one by the, I forget the name of that.
Eve.
MMO. Yeah, Eve Online, guys. That looks amazing. There's so many in the works, but there isn't one yet. There's nothing that's a killer app.
Our dev kit, old and busted. No, junk.
It's still the best you can buy today.
There have also been rumors that Sony is going to unveil like a competing device or something. There's been a lot of stuff with the PS4, them kind of like dancing around the issue of like, yeah, we're going to support, you know, like 3D in some way, but not saying they're going to support Oculus specifically. So if Sony's making a competitor HMD, that'll be crazy.
And if Valve,
actually supporting Oculus, though, like if there is a major console with native Oculus support encouraging developers to build that into their games, then
that would be justify a $75 million investment.
Yeah, then it is going to sell big money.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure I said this before, but when we met with Oculus at CES this past year, the person who was there in the room before us doing a demo was a Sony executive.
Yeah, if there was, I mean, even a partnership with Valve, like a real solid one, and they are very friendly. So,
which is weird because John Carmack is now on the board.
Yeah,
and is working on Oculus full time now.
And technically everything that Valve has released that has Oculus support and doesn't mention Oculus Rift, it mentions like VR mode.
Yeah,
so it's more generic. You'd think they might be working on their own hardware, but hopefully it's going to be a standard that they will create on their own, maybe involving a console manufacturer like Sony, because we need these guys to come together in order to create one universal standard so that this can take off.
Yeah, competing standards and a fracturing of the VR community would be too small for that. I mean, we want competition in the long run once the technology is right, but it's also proprietary now. We talked about moonshots earlier, and there was a literal moonshot last week. I'm sorry. I apologize.
No, it's good.
China landed on the moon. I'm shocked by how undercovered this was in the American media.
Well, if it had been a person... I'm sure it would have gotten more coverage if it had been a Chinese astronaut on the moon, but it was still pretty undercovered.
It was way undercovered. Black Friday was more covered. Amazon drones was more covered than China, than the first man-made drone robot landing on the moon since 1976.
Yeah.
Which is incredible.
Yeah, you're right.
What can you tell me about the robot itself and how it landed?
Nothing.
Because I don't know either. Yeah.
You would think at least there would have been some fear-mongering about it, right? Like someone talking about, like, oh, China's got a space program now.
I think that's the stupidest thing that any cable news person could do, fear-mongering about space exploration.
But if they didn't, anything at all, yeah, like, that implies caring even less than acting like...
Yeah, I want to be in that newsroom episode where they're deciding...
Oh, fuck off.
Do we cover the China moon lander, or do we cover what was the big news story? Beyonce's album, secret album release,
or do we cover Bigfoot?
Return to the moon is important, and I think a lot of people have their eyes set on Mars and pushing the frontier. I know Neil deGrasse Tyson has talked about that, but Chris Hadfield in his talk at NASA a couple months ago now, reiterated how important it is. The moon is so convenient. The fact that we have that the China mission seems uneventful to us is both politics, but also speaks to the fact that we, you know, it is over 50 years since we landed. Over 50 years? Almost 50 years.
Almost
50 years since we landed on the moon, or, you know, humans land on the moon. And while it's not routine, it is a technology and a process that just takes money. It's not something that's as risky as it once was. And destinations like International Space Station, projects like International Space Station as an experiment, and landing on the moon, that is a necessary step to get us to Mars. We can do a Mars shot, and it would take incredible resources. And yes, it would push the boundaries of our space exploration abilities, but we're nowhere near ready to do that until we figure out, you know, effects of long-term space living, fully recyclable systems for air, water, and waste. And the moon is the most convenient place to learn all those things.
And potentially as a staging ground for longer, because it's so much easier to launch from the moon than from the Earth's surface.
Yep.
My hope is that this spurs a little bit of good old-fashioned USA, you know, bullish, let's get back into space attitude. Because, you know, you mentioned Neil deGrasse Tyson. He and other people like Bill Nye have been saying for a long time that NASA's in way too much danger of being defunded, not having enough money to follow through with the projects they want to do. And, you know, if we get the public behind wanting to compete to get back on the moon or get into space with other countries, we start seeing other countries doing things that we're not doing, then we're going to probably see more funding in that direction. I mean, that was why we got there in the first place. Russia was the first one in space. They were the first one to do everything except land a man on the moon.
Yeah. We need a new space race. And so the NASA, what's that? The journal that they publish all the benefits of NASA research in everyday life. That needs reinvigorating.
Yes.
Yeah. Although the flip side of that is that this Chinese drone or probe is using like some of NASA's technology. And so the information that it gathers will, I believe, be kind of given to the international science community, supposedly. I don't know if...
That's part of the license?
I think it's... I don't know if it's part of the license or just kind of a general like scientists agreement so
that's cool.
So I don't know what this probe will gain, you know, what knowledge it will take from the surface of the moon that we don't have already, but it won't be useless, you know. It's just more data.
It just sucks that Americans don't care.
Hey, we care.
I'm sorry to generalize. It sucks that as a country, it seems like that a lot of people don't care. And what they rather care about is just buying stuff.
It's hard to compete with the 7 minutes of terror, right?
That's true. NASA has great PR. They those guys at JPL and those guys at Ames produce some nice videos. The 7 minutes of terror.
You know, I saw that at the JPL.
Really?
Yeah, they do one open house a year.
Uh-huh.
And they debuted a longer version of that, where that was the middle chunk.
Wow.
In the movie theater there. And I couldn't believe it.
Edge of your seat.
I was totally on the edge of my seat. I went back, because my wife didn't see it, my son and I saw it. I went back and I was like gushing, trying to tell my wife what an amazing thing we're about to do. And she was just like, where are the corn dogs? I couldn't communicate my enthusiasm.
Why aren't we at Disneyland? Tomorrowland. Well, this last bit of thing is something I found online. Ridiculous things. What's the most ridiculous thing you've bought in the holidays this year?
For the holidays?
For your friends, or it's okay, you can admit it. You bought maybe 1, 2, or 10 things for yourself.
Oh man, that's got to be something. I don't know.
Was it a money vault?
No. What, you got something?
No, but you can buy a money vault. There's an auction site.
What's a money vault?
It's a Scrooge McDuck Swiss franc money vault.
What are you talking about?
It is a vault that has safety deposit boxes.
Uh-huh.
On all four walls. And it is filled with several million Swiss francs that you can wade in.
Is this thing like 20, like how big is it? Is it a couple stories?
I think it looked like 10 feet, 12 feet tall. 12 feet by 12 feet.
What are you saying?
I'm guessing.
That's a little small, but...
buy access to this for 5 minutes?
No, you can buy it. They're selling it. The whole vault plus the coins, up for auction.
All right.
There was a great link that Jason Cocky put out about ridiculous millionaire auctions or things that you can buy on eBay right now. One of them was a full-size replica of a spacesuit, a NASA spacesuit. The
EMU, how much did that cost?
$9,000. It's only a replica.
That's not that much.
Fan-made replica. Not fan, but like it's one of the official replicas that they have like in Washington, D.C. in the museums. So it's not one that actually went into space, but uses the right like sewing patterns and type of fabric.
It's got to be cheaper than the Money Vault.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's definitely cheaper than the Money Vault. You can buy a brawn turntable. It looks gorgeous. I tweeted this last night. $1,500. Near mint condition. Still works. Timeless design. And some other ridiculous things. Oh, a real jacket that one of the Russian cosmonauts wore into space. It looked stylish jacket. Great photos, too.
How much did the Money Vault cost?
I think it was auction. I think the starting bid was several million dollars.
A weird thing.
It's a little on my price range.
A little bit. What's not out of our price range, and we still have a little bit of time. I'm let viewers and listeners know we're going to take a short break when we get to what we're testing because I have to make a quick phone call. But what's not out of our price range is a next project that we're going to do and test it. This is a little preview for next year. We're working on a MAME machine.
Now, what makes a MAME machine in 2014 any different than a MAME machine in 2004?
Not much.
It's harder in 2014 to get a good monitor.
Yes.
To get a CRT monitor.
Everything is more difficult to do now. There are fewer people making MAME a cabinet. So back at Maximum PC, if you guys followed this back then, one of our co-online editors, Alex Castle, built a MAME machine, MAME cabinet, and it looked great. It was awesome. This was like one of those coffee table cabinets with a flat screen. Jeremy,
been the Galaga machine because that's all that was played on it.
Well, no, there's also Crazy Climber. Yeah. Crazy Climber was the best. So four sets of controls. So for Crazy Climber, you could get your dual joysticks. Galaga was great. Donkey Kong was great on that. But the idea was that it was basically a PC in this cabinet. The cabinet you could buy the parts for from this New Jersey company.
By a kit, basically.
Wood kit,
everything pre-cut.
Everything pre-cut, pre-finished, nice. You had a big board on top. The monitor you could find relatively easy. And I think this was in 2009 or so that we built this. CRT monitor, which looked great. And then all the switches and everything you needed online. We're going to try to do that again, but much more difficult. So Wes is leading the way for this project. And what you found is that, you can't buy a cabinet.
Yeah, we've been planning for... Well, you can buy a cabinet. We've been planning this for like 2 or 3 months now.
Mm-hmm.
The guys that you bought a cabinet, the cabinet kit from, probably the best out there and had a reputation for being willing to like help you customize, you know, how you wanted your control layout, stuff like that. They got wiped out by Hurricane Sandy. And since then, their site has, for like the past year, has just had a notification that says like, our warehouse got destroyed by Hurricane Sandy. We're going to try to get back up and running at some point. That hasn't happened yet. There are a few other companies out there that do these similar kits, but not something that you could tailor to your own, you know, your own specifications. Fairly expensive, and also like a lot of them use like MDF, kind of mm-hmm. crappy wood.
Particle board,
right. So we kind of wanted, we wanted to change the dimensions a little bit to make sure we'd have enough room to have two players sitting around this cocktail cabinet on the horizontal side, and then have two on each end for, you know, the vertical side, whether you're doing four-player games or you're just sitting on one of those ends to play a vertical game like Pac-Man mm-hmm. and Donkey Kong. So we wanted to customize it a little bit, and the only way to do that really was to build it ourselves.
Yeah, to build a cabinet.
So that's what we're going to do.
So that's what we're going to do. Went to Home Depot, bought all the hardware, and bought giant sheets of plywood, 3/4-inch plywood.
So we got a ton of plywood.
A ton of plywood.
We did all the measurements for... We started out with the base Pac-Man mm-hmm. design, yes. cocktail design from the 70s.
Miss Pac-Man.
Well, there's Pac-Man and Miss Pac-Man, and a couple guys who are just... I guess, super dedicated about 10 years ago, I want to say, took those cocktail cabinets, measured everything, and wrote out extremely detailed plans of how to build one yourself. And so they have the listings of here are the kinds of joints you'll want to use. Here's how you'll put the wood together. Here are the hinges you're going to need that will support your monitor being built into the top of this thing. Here, you know, buy glue, buy, you know, you want to stain your wood. You're going to want to get this molding to go around the edge. So we went by their specifications, but then we modified a lot of the dimensions of the cabinet and actually went into SketchUp and kind of built the original version and then kind of measured things out. And we said, okay, we want to add 4 inches to this side. We're going to make it a little wider. We're going to make the control panels a little bit deeper so that we can do like a Japanese style layout where the button rows are curved instead of just flat. And then did a bunch of research into the types of joysticks and buttons we want to put into it.
It's not cheap. You got like joystick ball heads and the buttons from different manufacturers. You get concave, convex buttons. I mean, people who've been to California Extreme know all about this stuff. And it's been real fun. And then we built a cardboard model, and this will all be untested in the coming months.
You've already done a cardboard model?
Oh, yeah.
We did.
A life-size cardboard model to help figure out exactly how much surface area of wood we need. And got the wood, and then hopefully we'll be able to make it to Adam's shop and do some cutting and then sanding and finishing at the house. The biggest problem, though, so far right now is the monitor.
Getting a good monitor. Getting a monitor, period.
Period.
Without paying a shitload of money for it.
They've stopped making these monitors.
Yeah, so right around when you guys built your cabinet in 2008 or 2009 is when basically the few companies that were still making CRT arcade monitors stopped making CRT arcade monitors in the late 2000s. And basically everyone in the arcade community said, you can look at these threads, you know, in forums from a few years ago. They're like, they're stopping production. You know, we have so many in the warehouse. When they're gone, they're gone. That's it. And so people bought up the whole supply.
Hoarding.
And hoarding, stockpiling, because these monitors don't last forever. They do die. So most of these people have, you know, collected several monitors and they're just keeping them. And the only people selling them are usually very localized. And, you know, they're saying, okay, well, you can come. I have 200, you know, junker arcade units in my warehouse. You can come buy a monitor. It's still possible to get one cheap, sometimes even a really good condition one, but being able to get them online and shipped to you is a lot harder. Mm-hmm. You're going to pay a lot of money in most cases. There just aren't that many out there.
Right. And it's not just like a VGA CRT, there's specific resolutions that we want.
Yep.
And we're doing both we're going to go for a CRT because we want to be as authentic and great as possible, but also have an LCD alternative and show the differences for the story.
You know, I was going to say that there are excellent LCD emulators. I'm sorry, CRT emulators for LCD.
And Wes has written about them.
Yeah. So I was more focused on console stuff, like how the really good Super Nintendo emulator has shaders and stuff. But I did a little bit with MAME too.
Yeah.
And so we'll probably end up doing the LCD monitor first when we're showing stuff off. And I am definitely eager to try out the shaders. Forgot the name of the kind of the most popular ones off the top of my head. But those things do look pretty good, at least in screenshots. And it'll be interesting to compare how the fake scan lines and, you know, like CRT filters for changing how the colors, RGB filters and stuff like that, seeing how those compare on the LCD screen and then seeing if we can spot a difference between the 60 Hertz refresh rate and, you know, a CRT refresh rate.
And see if it's worth the weight difference.
Right.
That cabinet's going to be heavy with a CRT.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. And structural, you will need more stability.
Yep.
Because it'll be on that big hinge. I mean, that was always the most worrisome thing about the old cabinet. Every time you popped it open, you're afraid it was going to snap in half because of the weight of that monitor. So that's coming next year. It's still a work in progress, and just want to give a little tease for that. And we're learning all sorts of stuff, both about woodworking and assembly and finishing.
Yeah, our next thing to learn will be how to not cut any fingers or hands off while putting this thing together.
Valuable lesson.
Yeah.
Will there be a trackball?
Yes.
There will.
Will there be a spinner?
No.
No.
Oh. No Disotron.
And no... what's the one with the spinning? The one that The real popular one with the spinning.
Oh, Arkanoid.
No.
No. I don't know.
You know what I'm talking about.
I thought you meant Arkanoid. I don't. No. What do you mean?
What are the big spinner games? Oh, this is terrible.
I don't know.
Are you talking about the one Giant Bomb guys played all the time?
No. There's a spinner game. It's tall. You're like moving around the circle and things are coming at you. And
Tempest. That's true, yeah.
Tempest is the big spinner game.
Yep.
If we have some extra space, we'll see.
Yes, I vote add spinner. the nice thing is, though, if you make this and you decide to mass manufacture it, now you'll be able to outsource production to the moon. You like that? Sorry.
I'm sorry.
Now I'm sorry.
Well, we're going to take a real short break. If Joey can help us break here, I can do a quick phone call, and then we'll be back to talk about what we've been testing. For you, it will be hopefully immediately. We'll be back immediately, but bear with us for one moment. All right. We are back. Sorry for the brief interlude. I take a phone call. That's news. That's the MAME cabinet. Now I want to talk about what we've been testing. What we've been testing for the year. And it was a lot of stuff. So I've written down all the stuff I've been working on. I'm back on an iPhone for a couple weeks.
How's it feel, Norm? Good to have you back. We all knew it. Good to have him back on the podcast.
We got an email. iPhone.
The iOS users.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's nice to have you back.
Yeah. It feels weird. And the reason I'm back on the iPhone is I'm testing this thing called the Automatic. It's a dongle that you plug into your car.
It doesn't support Android.
Does not support Android.
Really?
Yeah.
That's surprising.
Will's actually, I think he was using it earlier this year.
It's just Bluetooth. Why wouldn't they? That's weird.
The app. It's because of the app.
All right.
But I'll be writing about that next week. But I think more interesting than the Automatic device, which I think is very interesting and a really cool concept, because if you tie it to your phone, you get your GPS locations. We talk about how scary Google location history was. Well, this is your driving history, path to path. And what's cool is that it tells you how much you're spending, approximately how much gas you're spending per trip. And yep. I find that much more useful than the warnings about hard braking and the warnings about driving over 70 miles per hour.
It's a reality check.
It just lets you quantify the driving experience a little differently. It's like, wow, I go driving on like weekend mornings because I like listening to like certain radio shows in the morning, and I only have a radio in my car. So I might as well run some errands while I listen to Prairie Home Companion or This American Life at noon or something, right? And it's like, well, that's costing me like $4 in gas every time I do that. Yeah, it's a little interesting. Yep. But the more interesting is my experience going back to the iPhone. And I have to be honest, when I switched to Android this year, I did it in the back of my head with the idea that maybe if I didn't like Android in 1 year, I would go back to iPhone next year. I could always go back. It would be easy to fall back to iOS and iPhone, because I was going to skip on the 5S. Didn't want to spend that extra $400. And maybe the iPhone 6 will be compelling enough that I could go back, because I'm comfortable. I was comfortable in iOS. Going back to iPhone.
Not just comfortable, happy.
I was happy. I was. I can't do it. I don't like it.
Yeah.
I don't like the screen size. I love the small.
So it's more the hardware than the software.
It's both. I think that the hardware and software, because they're melded, the hardware dictates the software. The hardware, the size of the screen, the 4-inch size of this iPhone 5 and the width of the phone, because the only difference between the 4S and the 5 was the height.
Yep.
That dictates how information is displayed and how app designers design, for example, reverse feed news updates, like apps like Twitter and Instagram, right?
Yeah.
And how much information you can cram into that width. And just having different aspect ratio screen and more pixels and just having the notification being much, much more useful.
Yeah.
Everything just feels so, like, every task I do on the iPhone feels isolated. It feels compartmentalized.
So, but if it was a bigger screen, and the app developers followed suit,
and iOS was catered to that,
then
who knows?
Who knows?
Who knows?
You're super widget heavy in your Android use, right?
It's widget heavy. It's the like mail in a home screen, like it's being able to see the mail, but most importantly, because getting so many emails and being a mail junkie, it's being able to do things in the notification control center, being able to swipe down.
Yeah.
see the new emails I get or whatever messages and be able to delete emails from there or play or, you know, adjust my music playback from there. It's OK Google, which I use a lot now on Nexus 7. It's just saying OK Google.
Yeah.
With Google Now, it's actually warming up to Google Now being one of my home screens and swiping over to the left.
You can't adjust music settings from anywhere.
I know you can't.
I'm just saying. My 6-year-old son doesn't know how to use a search bar, but he uses the web with OK Google, using the Google app on the iPad.
Wow.
Like, that's it. That's how he will always know the web. He's using the Star Trek computer, and that's how it works. Because he doesn't even know how to spell.
Yeah.
But he can say, OK Google, how do you make a minecart in Minecraft? And he'll get the YouTube video that tells him how to do that.
Brave New World.
Yep.
Also owned by Google.
What?
YouTube.
Minecraft?
No, YouTube.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Also weird to think about your son being able to play Minecraft but not being able to spell.
It's just Lego, you know, virtual Lego. It's a sandbox.
Yeah.
But that's like, spelling is basically just you have memorized this knowledge to be able to do something interactive in Minecraft. Like, to my mind, that is a harder skill.
Well, Wes, there's a whole generation of kids out there now, and I say kids, young people who just don't know how to write or write in cursive.
I can't write in cursive for shit.
Yeah.
I could when I was 12.
And I think this is just an extension of that. People can't write longhand. They can type, and now some people maybe will have less of a need to type and just use verbal communication. I mean, it taps into a different part of the brain. Speaking of sandboxes, I've also been testing this kinetic sand. Have you seen this, Jeremy?
I watched your video. It looks a lot of fun. I've been wanting to play with it since I saw it.
Now is your chance.
Excellent. I will move my computer well away.
98% sand, 2% some weird
science sand.
Science thing. It's one of those Brookstone things that you see when you go into the mall and then you just stay there playing with it all day long because it's the weirdest thing
ever. It's the gack of sand.
It is the gack of sand.
Can you still buy gack?
I think you can.
Yes.
You can make it.
Yeah. It was easy to make. There would be like library, you know, summer school projects.
Just like cornstarch and
glue. A lot of Elmer's glue.
And gack?
I think it was glue and cornstarch.
So this is sand and glue?
Sand and some chemical. It's non-toxic. It holds its form.
Does it dry out eventually?
No.
Really?
Yeah. The idea is that it works dry.
When you squeeze it together, what I couldn't see in your video is, now that I have it in my hands, when I squeeze it together and then separate it, you can see these fibers between the pieces of sand.
It blooms.
Yeah.
It blooms in this really awesome way, and it just falls apart. It's mesmerizing.
That's fun.
Yeah, definitely fun. I've also been testing the pencil. Got the pencil in.
I want one.
Would you like to try it?
Yeah, it's on my Christmas list.
All right.
I love the paper app. That's the
really?
Best. That's the best drawing app.
I've given it to, I'm not an artist, I've done light sketching with the paper app when I first tested that. But the pencil, and I haven't decided whether, I haven't come to any conclusions about it yet, but it feels like it is an imperfect solution to an imperfect problem.
Explain.
That trying to solve for having a stylus on the iPad is an impossible problem to solve because it's a capacitive screen that's not designed for that. And you're going out of your way, doing all these technical hoops and innovative things to solve for that, you're never going to find what you're looking for, which is the pen and paper, pencil paper experience because of just real technical limitations of the way Bluetooth and the way capacitive screens work.
Well, so why does moving the pressure sensitivity into the stylus?
Well, there's no pressure sensitivity on the pencil.
I thought that was the point.
No, paper has no pressure sensitivity. What paper does...
I no longer want one.
what the paper app has always done has...
No, I understand the app, but the pencil. I thought the pencil had pressure sensitivity.
No pressure sensitivity.
Well, what's it add? What's the deal?
There's an eraser. It's palm recognition.
Oh, right. Okay.
And palm recognition. So because it's Bluetooth based. The nub that's inside the tip of the pencil, which I feel like I have some problems, issues with that as well, activates, and so it knows that that point is where it should detect a mark on the screen, as opposed to you putting your palm on the screen.
Your palm?
Like when you're putting your palm on the screen to draw,
okay,
that's how it does the palm detection.
Okay.
It's also a $60 accessory for an iPad,
yep,
which is fairly expensive.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah. I'll be writing about it on the site, of course, but that's something I've been working on. I also have the Yoga Pro 2, which is Lenovo's new flagship consumer laptop. Like the Yoga 1 a lot. Like the Yoga 11S even more. Yoga Pro 2, I feel like this is a perfect example of a PC manufacturer building a PC for specs and not for user experience. It's a laptop with a 3200 3200 by 1800 resolution screen. 3200 pixels wide and 1200 pixels tall. So it's pixel
and it's
doubling.
It's a 13-inch screen, right?
13-inch screens. It's basically pixel doubling a 1600 by 900 display, which is a lot of pixels, but Windows 8 can't resolve it, even Windows 8.1. And also, my problems with it so far is that because of this high-resolution screen, battery life is just nowhere near a 13-inch MacBook Air with Haswell, even though this one does have Haswell. And also, the wireless has its 2.4 gigahertz 802.11 only, no 5 gigahertz, which I think is unacceptable. I had conversations with our technical Andrew Cunningham yesterday about it, and we both agree that is this laptop's biggest fault. But writing about that in a little bit as well. Quadcopters. We posted a story on the site earlier this week about getting into quadcopters. I know last time you were here, we talked about the Phantom, the DJ1 Phantom, D1J. Yeah.
There should be a new one.
There is, I think, coming out soon.
Any day.
That's a relatively expensive quadcopter.
$460. It has been for the past couple of months because they're trying to get rid of the old
one. Right. When the new one comes out, I'm sure it'll be between $600 and $800. But that one, you can put a GoPro on there. Comes with a transmitter. It's heavy duty. It's a really stable, big quadcopter. What we've been messing around with.
I'd like to see you put a GoPro on this one.
This one cannot fit. The quadcopter I've been testing is a small mini quad. And so the guy we had write our quadcopter guide, Terry Dunn, he was actually we met him at NASA. He was one of the suit managers at NASA. If you watch our NASA visit video, that's Terry in the video. Talk about the spacesuits, and he's done a couple of things for us on the side, but he's really into RC copters. He's in that community. He's written stuff for like RC magazines. And so his recommendation is don't buy a Phantom to start. Don't spend that much money. Buy something that's more manageable.
I bought the AR drone. Can I now move to a Phantom?
No, AR drone, and that's a big part of the story. The AR drone is a terrible hobby copter to start out with because it doesn't teach you the flight mechanics that you need. Mm-hmm. With a real transmitter, with a two-stick transmitter.
You messed up.
Yeah. We had the Air Drone, $300, spend the $100, get the, I've been using the Helimax 1SQ, and I'll show it to you after the podcast.
Yes.
It's a lot of fun.
Helimax makes it sound a lot more badass than it is.
Helimax.
It's a good name.
Helimax. I think it's Helimax, but in California, Northern California, we'll call it the Helimax.
But if I want to move straight to cinematography, I need the Phantom. I need that. You know, and
the point of the story is you shouldn't move straight into cinematography.
Yeah, well.
You shouldn't. Don't
do it anyway. Do it.
You're going to crash that copter in someone's backyard.
That awesome video we saw of the Phantom shooting, you know, all around the most beautiful sights in the world, it turns out that they also used a gimbal. Mm. Like, and those gimbals cost as much as the Phantom.
Jeez. Stabilization gimbal.
Yeah, they're active motors on the gimbal for two axes.
And is a separate person controlling that?
No, it's autonomous.
Okay.
So it uses an accelerometer, obviously. So you are asking if they can aim it.
Yeah.
I think they're like the Phantom can do one
axis
for tilt. But as far as stabilization, it's all autonomous. But yeah, you're talking about a $1,200 investment.
Right, at least.
Plus a GoPro.
Plus the $300 GoPro and extra batteries and all those accessories. Yeah. And you know, months of practice and training. Do the practice first.
With your Helimax, gladly.
Absolutely. And the last thing we've been testing, I'm not sure we'll do write about this on the site, is Joey just got in a new piece of camera equipment. It's the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Cam, which is apparently very popular in the filmmaking community. Adam actually just got two of them for Mythbusters shooting to replace their GoPros. So when we went to NAB last year, this is the National Association of Broadcasters Convention, where all the new professional cameras are released, Blackmagic, who makes capture cards, announced a camera, which everyone was really into. This idea was a relatively affordable 2.5K camera. It shoots high resolution, and you can adapt. You put Canon EF lenses on there. I don't think that camera has been well received. A lot of the problems that people had that are having are things that we initially thought would be problems in terms of not enough manual controls. The Pocket Cinema camera, which they announced later in the year and has been out for a couple months now, looks more like a mirrorless camera design. And it is a mirrorless sensor design because it uses a Micro Four Thirds size sensor and Micro Four Thirds adapter, which means you could use the entire history of Olympus and Panasonic lenses, of which there are many. And it shoots in ProRes, in RAW, and if you do some color grading afterward, you can get some really, really nice HD low light footage, and it has SDI outs. And so Joey got one in. We're going to use that as we're going to test it as a studio camera, as a field camera, as a B-roll camera, and it's a lot cheaper than, I think it's $1,000 for the camera, a lot cheaper than, you know, $10,000 Sony camera.
It's a very manly looking camera, like very intensely.
That's because he put in a special case.
Okay.
You're talking about the case. The rig that he has it in is a very intense rig with a lot of places to screw in attachments.
It's like the grown-up Erector set
camera
rigs.
Yeah. They sell a lot of those camera rigs. Have you guys been testing anything? Any new products?
3DS.
You got a 3DS?
I did.
Really? I just read this is funny. There's an article on The Verge about the Sega 3D Classics.
Okay.
They're supposed to be really good.
Yeah, yeah, and the article is just about that, but it's a little over the top. You start talking about how the Sega 3D Classics are far and away the best uses of 3D on the system, and how one of them is, like, 3D aside, will give you the most visceral graphical experience you've ever seen.
What?
Yes.
Wow.
So
ever?
So I it like
is it Echo the Dolphin? Was that the one?
One of them he mentions is Echo the Dolphin. The one that in particular is it's like Galaxy something. I'd never played it, but I did recognize the arcade machine. I'll find it in a second. But anyway, it got me to buy one. I bought one today.
A 3DS?
No. I had a 3DS, but it had been collecting dust.
You bought one of the classics?
So I bought one of the classics. Yeah.
I got a 3DS, and I actually bought games for it before I bought it because I was waiting for a Black Friday deal and ended up like getting it on Amazon's like $150 deal a few days before Black Friday. But a couple weeks before that, Target had been doing like buy two get one free, like cheap deals or whatever. So I ended up buying a couple 3DS games, three 3DS games before I had the system. Now I have like eight because I kept buying, like I would keep seeing them on sale for like 10 or 15 bucks. I bought Star Fox 64 3D for like $12 because it was on sale, and
wow.
I'll play enough Star Fox to get $12 out of it. And I bought a couple other games.
Animal Crossing.
Just started Fire Emblem last night after beating XCOM. And XCOM is great, but I already like Fire Emblem more.
You got the big 3DS?
I did get an XL, yeah.
Those were on sale for $150 now. That was a good deal.
Most people say so. It has got a lot better battery life than the smaller one. The trade-off is the screen, since the screens are bigger, especially the top screen, less pixel density. Mm-hmm. Nintendo games or 3DS games in general are already going to be kind of pixely, so I think that's not a big deal.
I found, though, that it had a slightly wider field of view so that you don't, like with the original 3DS, you have to find that 3D sweet spot. It's real narrow, and I easily fell out of it, but with the big one, I didn't as easily.
It's still been pretty narrow for me, but I imagine that the smaller one's probably even worse.
The game that the Verge mentions is Galaxy Force 2. You guys remember that in the arcade?
No.
I never played it.
It was one of those sit-down, you know, had all kinds of motors in it.
It's the kid that John Connor's friend was playing in Terminator 2. Or John Connor was playing in Terminator 2.
Maybe.
Was it?
No. This was later than that, I think.
Okay.
Anyway, it's like Afterburner in space, and you go through stuff. The quote, the money quote, is the spiraling columns of fire and complex space environments are some of the most visually intense graphics you'll see all year.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah,
all right.
I'm skeptical, but I have heard
sold.
That their 3D, I think they put like a year into those 3D ports.
Yeah, the best thing about this article is they link to the developer's blog, and there's a lot of information on how they port to 3D. It's
really
interesting.
I love those developer blogs. Jeremy, I want to backtrack just a second, for which I will... Were you here last time when we did like, I got to go back one segment?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah. I got to go back a segment because Wes talked about pixel density, and this is something that I think only you're one of the few people who can relate to and maybe appreciate.
Love my pixels.
You got you have a mini Retina.
Correct, yeah.
Right.
If it's new in Apple,
are you getting the new Mac Pro, which is also out today?
No, you can't. Okay. Right. No, actually, that's the one I decided I wouldn't need.
That's the one you decided you wouldn't. The $3,000.
Good to decide you don't need the really expensive one.
Okay. So the Mini with Retina, the way iOS software works on iPad between the iPad Air and the Mini with Retina is it scales it down. It just because it's the same number of pixels. Right. It's 2048 by 1536 resolution on both those tablets, and iOS doesn't know if it's running an app on the Mini Retina. The Mini or the full size iPad. Okay. So all it does is just render the pixels, and because the pixels are smaller,
it just
everything looks a little smaller and more compact. So sharper with quotes, right?
Yep.
The Mini with Retina uses the same pixel density screen as the iPhone 4, 4S, 5, 5S, 326 pixels per inch.
Hmm.
We know this because when last year's Retina came out, the OG 1024 by 768 Retina came out, people found that it used...
Mini?
Mini. The Mini came out. It used the same pixel density screen as the 3GS, and people were speculating they would save on production costs or by using existing manufacturing processes, existing suppliers, and just cut bigger sheets as opposed to cutting a 3.5-inch 3GS screen, which they discontinued. You would get a 7.9-inch Mini screen, lower pixel density, but 1024, 768. And so when you pixel double that, you get same pixel doubling from 3GS to 4 and the 5S and the 5, you get a 326 pixels per inch, right? Follow me so far.
I hope I don't have to answer a math problem after this, though.
A lot of numbers. Something I noticed is that on the Mini with Retina, which should be very independent, both on the software and the hardware side than on the iPhone line, because iOS on iPad and iPhone are just different. They render differently. Like iPhone, an iPod Touch, the text is rendered for that screen, optimized for that screen.
Yeah.
The text, the system text and system menus on the Mini with Retina and the system text and the system menus on the iPhone are exactly the same size physically.
Okay.
So which is weird.
Think it's designed to look like an iPhone as opposed to an iPad Air?
It's weird because it...
You said yourself it's the same pixel density.
Right, but it should be... It's independent of pixel density, how the text renders. Because the full-size iPad, it was just a shrunken-down version of the full-size iPad. The pixel density, the way text renders on the iPad Mini is more a factor of the size reduction from the full-size iPad than any relationship with the iPhone.
Is the text bigger on the full-size iPad?
Yes, okay. It is.
So okay.
It is bigger. The text on the full-size iPad has no relation at all to anything with the iPhone.
Yeah.
But once they
you're saying that the
squish that down...
Text is married to pixel density.
Maybe.
But that's independent of the graphics.
Independent of the UI rendering.
Yeah.
Of app rendering or anything else. Maybe that's the case, but also the menu bars, like the height of the menu lines, also exactly the same, even though there are one's iOS for iPhone, one's iOS for iPad. This made me think about if Apple were to make a bigger iPhone, they would just go backwards and cut the bigger smaller sheets from the iPad Air screen, and then you just get the iPhone scaled up, still 1136 by 640, but on a 5-inch screen.
Is that the Retina?
And that would be the same resolution if you scaled up those pixels.
I think you're exactly right. I would put money on that.
And because if you take an iPhone or iPad Air, which is 2048 by 1536, and you cut just a 1136 by 640 pixels out of that corner, it would be exactly 5 inches.
I think you have done it.
It would be not 1080p or 720 even. It would be lower pixel density than iPhone 5, but same aspect ratio, 5 inches, and everything looks a little bigger. Mm-hmm. And I think Apple could get away with it.
Yep.
I think they could get away with it by giving it extremely long battery life.
Could they still call it Retina?
I think yes, yeah. Because you're holding the a bigger phone further away from your face.
Well, it's because the same pixel density as the iPad Retina.
iPad Air.
If Retina. They can get away with still calling it Retina, then yeah, they'll do it.
I just wonder if they can get away with releasing a phone in 2014 that doesn't have 720p resolution.
Yeah, but you're right. But consistency for the developer community is one of the things they've got going for them.
But yeah,
resolution consistency.
I think they'll probably double again before they do that.
But oh my God, you think so?
I think that's a mistake. I think doubling again, you're gonna like we saw with pixel doubling on the first, the third gen iPad. You need a bigger battery, brighter LCD.
Yeah.
I know they have the new LCD process for the iPad Air. And
faster processor.
And faster processor. I think the bigger value proposition is consistency in developers and development pipeline, but also bigger the bigger form factor, which I know some people want, and putting a massive battery in there and getting like 2-day battery life.
I don't have a good sense for how like common the just typical buyers who don't read, you know, tech blogs and stuff.
Right.
How much do they care about that spec race?
I don't think they care in actual usage, but I do think they do care in, I think the tech blogs and the general like buzz and complaints seeps into mainstream consciousness, whether it actually matters or not.
Right.
For
like
example,
a Galaxy S4 having a 1080p screen or whatever, I don't know how much that ultimately affects sales versus the iPhone's lower res screen,
but
it definitely affects it some.
Yeah.
So the question is how much?
The mini with Retina is supposed to have a crummy display compared to the Nexus 7 and the Fire Kindle.
Right.
But I don't know how much people care, like you say, Wes. People who use it.
I think that also contributes to people, the iPhone 5C not selling well. The mainstream media and the enthusiast press just saying what a better phone the 5S is and what the extra $100 gets you in terms of processor, and calling the 5C a cheap phone, just like being louder than Apple's marketing.
It's not cheap, it's colorful.
That's right.
Can't do slow-mo.
Sorry for doing that tangent, but I want to put that out there and have that conversation with you, because it's something that I feel like...
You're going to put an egg on it?
You should mock that up. You should be the first people on the
web. I've written about it already on the site.
Okay.
But I don't know if people care.
Put an egg on it.
What does that mean?
It is the end of the year. I'm going to put an egg on it. There you go, guys. I, Norman Chan, hate hard-boiled eggs with a passion. I don't care how you cook it. I don't care if it's sous vide, hard-boiled, or in a big pot. I hate hard-boiled eggs. But if Apple does not release a larger iPhone next year using a screen that's basically the same PPI as the iPad, full-size iPad.
Air,
which is a gorgeous screen. I will eat a hard-boiled egg 1 year from now.
There it is.
I've put an egg on it. And that takes us to the end of the year. CES is coming up. I'm going to CES. Wes, you're not going to CES.
Probably. Who knows? Who knows?
Are you talking with Blam from Wirecutter and figuring it out?
Yeah, something like that.
Okay. So maybe Wes is going to be at CES. We're not driving down this year, but we will be flying down. Unfortunately, we're not going to be doing our live streams, but we're going to try to pump out a lot of videos while we're there and do some impromptu stuff, especially for premium members. We'll be there Monday through Thursday. We already have a bunch of meetings set up. So if you expect that we'll be doing something with Oculus, that's reasonable. Maybe something with Valve. I'm crossing my fingers. And then earlier this month, we have a backlog of content. Joey's he's working right now on editing like all this video footage we've shot in the past month and a half. Joey and I visited this place called Kerner Works, which was really cool.
The real doll factory.
It wasn't a real doll factory.
That's just what everyone on Twitter
thought
it was.
That's what people on Twitter thought it was. Jeremy, have you heard of Kerner Optical?
I've heard of Real Doll.
not the same.
It's kind of the same.
When ILM moved to the Presidio, a bunch of ex-ILMers started an effects company. I guess they were already doing effects up in stayed in North Bay as Kerner Optical. Kerner was the code name for ILM when Star Wars was being made. Kerner Optical.
Cool.
Kerner Optical no longer exists, but there was a spinoff division called Kerner Works that did the hardware. It was a fabrication plant. Did a lot of model effects and a lot of people who worked with Adam and Jamie on old models for movies. They now don't work in movies, and instead they're a company that makes robots, high-end robots, mannequins for the military, for medical training.
Oh. They are badass and creepy.
They are robots that can breathe, that can bleed, and that you can operate on, and incredibly lifelike, because we're talking about people with special effects history and pedigree. So all the blood effects and all the painting looks very real, and that the military buys and trains field medics to deal with trauma situations and how they can deal with the psychology of...
So you can actually perform CPR on this robot.
It's not just CPR. You can stick a tube down its throat.
Trachem.
You can stick a needle through...
Bring it back to life.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. So I went to visit that and talked to the guy there, the director of Kerner Works, and some of the people who work there. It's super cool. Wow. But it's a real interesting story that these were ex-special effects people, and they just kind of adapted.
Yeah.
And
did they go that extra mile that special effects guys would? Over just the guys
they started with. They definitely do over their competitors, I think. But they admitted that they didn't need to be as realistic as something put on film because they're mass producing, mass manufacturing, you know, dozens of these for the government.
Do they make sound?
No.
No.
They don't. You know what? I'm not sure. I have to follow up with that.
Because the first thing you're supposed to ask somebody is, are you okay?
Yeah.
I guess they can't, if they can't speak.
If they're coughing up blood and they have amputated, you know, if their leg's blown off, then... It's just going to be a lot of screaming.
Yeah, these aren't heart attack victims. These are bombshell victims.
Oh, sorry.
We have more talking rooms going up on the site. I think one actually just went up on the site today with Damon Lindelof, the co-creator of Lost. It was a real, real interesting interview that Adam did. We also had iFixit in our office. Kyle Weens from the CEO of iFixit came by a couple weeks ago and we shot a bunch of teardown videos. So if you haven't seen those, please check them out. They are great. And they're not our traditional teardown videos where we're fumbling over parts and breaking things. I know some people like those as well, destroying beautiful things. But Kyle actually pre-disassembled. We didn't want to redo the teardowns that they've already done for their site. So we nulled them out on our table and went over individual components and talked about the components and repairability and manufacturing processes. Because he's really interested in repairability and recyclability of products because we shouldn't be buying new phones, you know, every year. The phones that are very difficult to recycle. They're tough to source these components. So fascinating stuff. We have three more of those going up on the site for the rest of the year. Zoidberg projects still going on strong. I was talking to Frank yesterday about some animatronic stuff that might be happening to give you a little bit of a teaser on our Zoidberg costume. So please check that out.
You've got your 12 Days of Christmas videos. I've been enjoying those.
We do. Thank you. I apologize now to everyone for not looking at the camera for those.
I didn't want to ask.
We had a miscommunication where we shot all of mine in one day, and I looked at the coverage camera the whole time. It was a very busy day, and that's a terrible excuse, and there is no excuse. It's not artsy. And we didn't have time to reshoot them because, like I said, Joey has a ton of stuff to work on. But I hope you've been enjoying them. They're not really gift guides. They're just like a little showcase of things that we liked and things that we've bought and things that and how we use them. You know, weird things like that kinetic sand over there. And that's it for the year. I want to go over the year in review. What were your guys' favorite moments, favorite products? Your big winners, losers. We'll do predictions at the very end.
Well, clearly Jeremy's favorite moment was the kid showing his family his iPhone video.
Oh, the Apple ad? That was your favorite moment of the year?
He's misunderstood.
Look, I'm not saying I didn't cry. That's a good commercial. My favorite moment, though, was probably when I received my Oculus Rift. Because that's, I mean, that's just so exciting.
Before or after using it?
Oh, no. Using it, I was probably even better. But unboxing it and seeing the care that they put into a Kickstarter project, the case to the, you know, physical design of the thing itself, and then booting up Unity and trying to, you know, make something. It was just a blast. I mean, that was a major, major milestone, I think, in gaming, but certainly in my year.
I want to say, yeah, in terms of winners this year, Oculus was probably the biggest winner. And it filled up the entire year. CES was the first big showing of Oculus. I think Will had backed it when we were back at the old whiskey office. So that's like, we're talking early 2012 is when that was backed. And 1 year later, getting it, seeing them in CES, them winning best of show at CES, and people just getting a sense. Everyone, it had that like just buzz. Like once someone used it, you wanted to speak only in hyperbole.
And it was done by indies, you know. Any of the console manufacturers could have done this. But nobody had faith in VR.
It reminded me a lot of, and I hate to go back to Apple, but in 2007, just the perfect timing of technologies and products and chips being at the right cost and accelerometers being in the right place and capacitive touchscreens for something like the iPhone to be released and Apple just being on that. And now Oculus. This time
it was a 21-year-old.
And this time it was Palmer Luckey and his friends. And he had been tracking VR for a long time.
Yeah.
And so he knew when the technology would be right. And then just having that foresight to do this. And then following through in a big way. It's incredible.
That's mine.
That's the big winner this year. Kickstarter, another big winner this year. We keep on... I remember doing the math back then because the first big Kickstarter was the video game, was the Telltale. Double Fine's project.
Double Fine Adventure.
And we were doing the math because Kickstarter tells you how much they take, what cut they take. How is this sustainable as a company, right?
Yeah. Well, it wasn't.
And Kickstarter as a...
Oh, for Kickstarter, not
Kickstarter.
Not
like, how can this be a multi-million dollar company if they're taking 5% of $10,000 projects here and there and with tons of competitors, Indiegogo and all sorts of crowdfunding programs, but Kickstarter this year, for good or for and bad, as a way, you know, as a pre-order mechanism, as a way for filmmakers, professional filmmakers to get funding, has just exploded into the mainstream. And it is one of those things that a metric of how successful one of these services are, like Amazon, for example, you can go back and see how many things you bought from Amazon over the years. It's fun actually to go like, oh, in 2005, I bought 4 things from Amazon. And like when Prime hit, I doubled that, you know? And like this year, I bought 10 things a month from Amazon, right? And you can go into your Kickstarter history and just look, you know, wow, you did the indie game, the movie project, you know, one Kickstarter way back 2 years ago. And now people are doing backing Kickstarters left and right.
Yeah, you're right. What a successful company. I mean, and they used to be, at least, probably still are, very picky about who can be on Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. They have very strict rules about it. It's not like they're letting everybody in. They're not making as much money as they could be.
Yeah. I mean, it's spun off a whole subcategory of content coverage and like Kickstarter of the week and Kickstarter summaries.
Yeah.
You know, here are the things you should be on the lookout for that's launching on Kickstarter this week. This week I backed a rubber band machine gun.
You already have one of those.
No, I have a shotgun, the rubber band shotgun. This is a fully automatic machine gun that holds 672 rubber bands.
Oh my Whoa. God, that's different.
You load it 14 at a time. But even when you load them 14 at a time, it takes 48 loads to get to 672.
Are you like manually loading there's
a mechanism.
Priming?
If you pay the $100 backing level, you get the fast loader mechanism, which lets you like crank back and load 14 at once. And it includes 700 rubber bands, fully automated. It looks great. $85 for it. I thought it was a good deal. Anyway, I think Nexus devices had a real big success this year. Nexus 5, Nexus 7 for sure.
Nexus 5 and Nexus 7 just being so cheap and compared to pretty much everything else off contract. And
being so cheap, and I think also kind of making OEM partners are bitch. Like, OEM partners are now, and Samsung doesn't care. I don't think we'll see another Samsung Nexus device ever. Because Samsung wants the margins Apple has. And Samsung doesn't need, Galaxy is its own brand. And Galaxy is a brand that's opposed to Nexus. But HTC and LG are all beholden to this Nexus program now.
Yeah, it kind of seems like it's Google Nexus, Google Motorola.
Yep.
And then Samsung is kind of the big independent name. And now like HTC and LG.
And Asus.
and ASUS, like, they make their own stuff that isn't Nexus stuff, but it's right. not really selling.
You think about the ASUS, like the pads, whatever they're called.
Transformer?
No. The Nexus 7 pad, like pads, because ASUS made last year's and this year's Nexus 7s, but they sell their own version, also cheap. One, they're forced to sell it cheap now because Nexus has kind of established this high quality, low margin model, which Google obviously doesn't care about. They just want more Android devices out there. Like, Google could not care less about the margins on these devices. Google has the marketing strength, which just is Android strength. And it's a catch 22 for OEMs like LG. Like, they want to sell the LG G2 because it's their flagship, it's their best phone, but they also have to devote manufacturing to building Nexus 5. And it's not just like you can just put a new case on the same phone. It is basically taking those components and building a whole new assembly line for the Nexus 5. And they do it at the expense of the G2, or maybe because the G2 failed.
Why does Apple care any more than Google about margins on the hardware if it's just an OS grab in order to get people
Apple
to use their services?
Apple is not an OS grab. But Apple is a hardware grab.
Yeah. I know they make a lot of money on hardware. But
that's they only make money on hardware.
They make money on their services. You get the
so little as a percentage.
All right.
You look at these, Dan Lyons, I think, does a... I'm sorry, not Dan Lyons.
Dan Rather.
No. One of these bloggers does these great charts after every Apple quarterly earnings report, just showing the distribution of where the revenue is coming from. And you can see, you know, iPod slowly going down, Mac staying steady but not really growing, and it's iOS and hardware just... being where all the growth is.
And are the services embedded in those?
No,
services. That's a separate category.
And very small.
All right.
In terms of iTunes and apps.
App Store. Their 30%.
Yeah. And so back to Google. I mean, I think this next program, I think for a company like HTC and even Samsung to some extent, the Google Play program is what they wanted out of Nexus. Google Play. You know, you get the full price phone, $650. HTC gets... majority of that. You get users are happy. They get a Google Play experience, you know, without the skins. But Nexus kind of screwed that. Like, if you were to say, if someone were to ask, you know, should I get the Samsung Galaxy S4 Google Play Edition for this much or a Nexus 5 and you're on AT&T or T-Mobile, I could not say, don't get a Nexus 5.
You could not say don't get a Nexus 5.
I could not say don't get Nexus 5. I would have to say get the Nexus 5. So great year for Nexus, and who knows next year? There's always rumors about the Nexus 8. And I think Netflix, also the other big winner this year. I think a huge success with its original programming.
Their stock came back, baby.
Oh, yeah.
I'll tell you that.
Huge. I mean, we don't cover financials, but this year Facebook bounced back. Netflix skyrocketed. Amazon stayed high. And
thanks,
Google
House of Cards.
High. And it's not like every show they've done has been a success. I think Arrested Development was received critically poorly. But House of Cards in terms of building...
That paid off by the hype.
Oh, yeah.
Everyone was excited about it. Yeah.
And got people just aware of original programming. Orange is the New Black.
Led people to House of Cards, mm-hmm. which was awesome.
Which that second season trailer is already out. And even their original movies. Have you guys seen the trailer for the Mitt and Romney documentary? It's a Netflix original.
I haven't seen the trailer.
It came out yesterday. And I was a little disappointed that they... I know why they do it. They release trailers for their shows. Like, they released the season 2 House of Cards trailer this week and also that Mitt Romney documentary trailer. But it seems so un-Netflix for me to be able to watch that trailer.
But not watch the show.
And not immediately watch it right there. Like, instant gratification.
You would have done it.
Because I would have done it. I was like, you know what? That trailer's awesome. And while I was watching the trailer, I'm like, I'm going to set the next 2 hours of my time to watch this movie. And I have to wait till January 24th.
You know, another winner for me is audio. It's been an audio year for me.
No.
I mean, every time I actually consider, I still think about buying music. And then I realize, wait, I've got audio.
You mean streaming music services in general, subscription services.
Spotify, audio, those seem like the two big ones to me. I guess Spotify is bigger, but I'm an audio.
They have more selection, but...
It's the Xbox PlayStation war of the music
I guess
age.
So, yeah.
When I used them, Audio had a much nicer user experience and way better discoverability.
I like it because it's web-based.
Like, Spotify has
Spotify's
a good...
web player.
Do they? Because when I was checking it out, you had to download the app.
There is a web player now.
Gotcha.
Spotify has a really good back catalog. Like, if you want to listen, if you know what you want to listen to, they have it pretty much.
Yeah.
But RDO, if you don't know what you want to listen to, they have really good recommendations and discovery based on genre or what your friends are listening to, or this artist is like this other artist and stuff like that.
Pretty I mean, that's where, in terms of music recommendation services, where Last FM and Pandora kind of fall by the wayside because they're non-subscription models and they're beholden to DMCA regulations, which has kind of screwed them in terms of how many royalties they have to pay. And Pandora's been, it's public and it's doing doing relatively well in terms of it being a significant portion of internet bandwidth and how many millions of users they have. People love free, but it has not been profitable as a whole just because they have to pay so many royalties. And Spotify, coming from someone like Sean Fanning.
The Napster guy?
Napster. That's Sean Fanning. The Facebook guy. Parker. Sean Parker.
Also the Napster guy.
Was he also the Napster guy?
Yeah.
I guess there were two Seans. Yeah. Sean Parker and having and going directly to the studios and doing business relationships and now to getting exclusive content. Like, that's where the next battlefield's going to be in terms of RDO versus Spotify is exclusives.
Who's going to get the next Beyonce?
Yeah, who's going to get it first, at least for 2 weeks? And that's that. I mean, it is like the console war. We're talking about finding parity and getting exclusives. Did you just watch that South Park episode? The trilogy of the console war. The third episode was awesome. So great, so great. Big losers of this year. NSA stuff. The public.
Yeah, the government and the public.
Yeah.
Everyone, yeah, that terrible 60 Minutes, CBS 60 Minutes interview.
I think healthcare is is probably the biggest failure.
Tech
of,
failure.
Like, things that are important and matter, that was a total failure.
Yeah, not everything we've talked about before this actually really doesn't matter to our everyday lives. Healthcare matters.
Yeah. And for, like, the companies involved in doing that being such big names and having supposedly brilliant people working at them, for that site to fail as hard and completely as it did, it's pretty unacceptable.
As someone who has to buy health insurance, that sucks.
I haven't even tried because what's the point?
I think wearables has failed this year in terms of how hyped up it was.
What's a wearable? Like a Fitbit?
Something like the wearable computing. Just like,
if you thought that Galaxy Watch was going to be good,
Samsung thought it was going to be good.
You mean like the Pebble?
Like the Pebble.
Yeah.
I think the Pebble didn't explode nearly as much as I think people thought it would.
Made $10 million on Kickstarter, and
I haven't seen a Pebble.
You think it's it's in Best Buy? I don't know.
Yeah.
Is it ahead of its time, you think?
Or? I think it's ahead of its time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Next year might be the year for that. I mean, quantifying your life is big now. People love it. And finding the right way to do a wearable piece of technology that might not need a camera and can last for longer than a day of use is going to be pretty important. I think the right confluence of technologies and costs isn't there just yet. We're still waiting for someone to do that well. And then Windows 8 and Windows Phone.
Still kind of sucks.
Windows Phone, nothing. I mean, there was a big Nokia purchase this year. Approved. It's going to happen. I haven't heard anything about Windows Phone in the past 2 months. And I know I'm not following it as much as some people online and Windows fans. And I know there are a lot, but this was supposed to be, how much longer can you wait before it gets any traction?
So yesterday or the day before, I was talking to one of my uncles who just bought a new laptop, just got like a cheapo laptop at Walmart or something on Black Friday, has Windows 8 installed on it, has a touchscreen. And I was walking him through some process. I was trying to get him Dropbox so I could send him something. And the user interface of Windows 8, he's like, well, he was glad he could touch it, but he didn't notice the difference between like the desktop and the web browser because of like the way things are full screen for every app. So I was like, okay, go to your desktop. There's a folder for Dropbox. The file will just go there. And he's like, okay, I'm in Dropbox, blah, blah, blah. It's wanting me to download it. And I'm like, are you on the website for Dropbox or in the app for Dropbox? And he's like, oh, I'm in Internet Explorer.
Which is full screen.
Yeah. And I mean, that's a relatively small problem, but I think it speaks to just how terribly designed Windows 8 is.
Yeah. I think that the idea of, on desktop at least, not compartmentalizing the experience in full screen apps like you can do on a phone and a tablet is a big thing. And I think that Microsoft committed too much to that with their full screen modern retro apps. Anything else? Any other big winners or losers you guys think of? You guys follow tech? Tesla? Tesla is a big winner this year.
Sure.
The electric car?
Yeah, that's true. They handled that PR debacle pretty well with the one that caught on fire.
Which was so dumb, I think.
I mean, I guess Tesla did have a few PR
I think they
problems
ended up,
this year in terms of gas mileage.
They benefited from that one, I think, in the end, because it was like the New York Times writer or New York something writer, and then they fired back with, we track journalists' things. Here's all our data, and I think that probably was good buzz for them overall.
I think it's still very early days for Tesla. You know, I think that they haven't had their winner year yet.
Are you an early adopt? I mean, you haven't early adopted
yet. It's too
late.
No. I mean, no, I'm not going to get a Model X. Maybe the next one.
Next S is going to be the big one. It's like the Prius.
Yeah.
You want the second or third gen Prius. That's when it really hit its stride. Yeah, the first one looks so ugly anyway.
The Model X looks pretty awesome, though. It's got the gull wing doors.
Falcon wing doors.
That's the SUV,
Falcon,
right?
Sorry,
Falcon
you're wing. Right, because they bend.
They bend.
It's really cool.
All right, let's go... go over predictions both last year and this year. And I'm sorry we didn't recall our predictions from last year. Gary and Will were both here last year, and we all three of us said some really stupid things. So please, podcast listeners, dig up the podcast, the last episode from last year, and tell us all the things that we got wrong. I don't care what we got right. I just want to know what we got wrong and post them in the comments below. I know I said some really stupid things. I wish I had hard-boiled eggs. No, I don't wish I had hard-boiled eggs to eat right now. There was no Apple TV. I guess all the console stuff, most of the console stuff we said came true. No 4K. 4K never took off. Still waiting for that to happen.
I mean, it exists. You can buy it.
Yeah,
but
never took off. I don't remember recall what our predictions were from last year, but let's make some predictions for next year. 2014.
I was going to say 4K because the HDMI 2.0 spec is now done, but no one's had time to implement it. It'll be in probably as of very early next year, if not already as a firmware update. And 4K prices are now almost affordable. You can get 4K TVs for $3,000.
You can get 4K monitors for well under that, half of that. Dell has two 4K monitors.
Yeah.
They have a 24-inch and also a 32-inch, both over $1,000, but they will have one under $1,000 that's 28 inches.
Yeah, I'm talking about like 55-inch TVs. Yeah. You know, you can get, a year ago they were $10,000,
mm-hmm.
and then they went down to maybe $5,000, and now they're finally really coming down around Christmas. So I'm saying 4K is, 2014 is the year of 4K. It will be for me.
I'm very skeptical about the scalers in those TVs.
The scalers look great even this year.
At CES.
Right.
But those aren't the TVs that are on sale for $500, $1,000, through $2,000.
4K content, also delivery methods still need to be worked out.
Netflix has leaked that they may
that's low
be
bit
involved.
Rate.
Yeah, I know, but it'll still be the right res. Bit rate is not something people care about. I'm telling
that's,
you.
That's so sad.
There's one thing MP3 and Netflix
that
has taught us.
So, but MP3...
It's
so,
convenience trumps quality.
Wow. A little bit of a disappointment. Let's go around the circle. Jeremy, you started. You said 4K is going to be a thing next year.
Yeah. Do I just get one thing?
We're going to go in a circle. We're going to keep on going until we run out of predictions. But that's the tested tradition. I will go next. Apple TV next year. I'm saying it.
Just happening.
Apple TV as a... I might have said the same thing last year. Apple TV as a physical TV.
Can you make the prediction about what makes it a killer TV besides that cool logo? Because that's the question that still remains in my head.
That is. If I had the answer, I wouldn't be working here.
Okay.
I'm going to think about that for a second.
Can I interject?
You can.
I think it might be cloud-based DVR for every station.
So you think they're going to work out the content partnerships with...
Yep.
All the content providers.
I do.
Okay. Wes.
NVIDIA G-Sync is going to be big. big deal for monitors.
Explain to people what NVIDIA G-Sync is.
So G-Sync is NVIDIA's, like, their solution to getting rid of V-Sync and getting rid of, I don't know how to describe it. So
tearing? Screen tearing?
Screen tearing. So V-Sync is done to eliminate screen tearing by aligning, by keeping your graphics card only pumping out frames at the frame rate of your monitor.
The refresh rate.
The refresh rate of the monitor. But then you can get stuttering because the card is producing frames too quickly or too slowly. G-Sync aligns what your card puts out to the monitor's refresh rate, right? Am I getting that right? Or is it now refresh rate is not locked at 60 yes. hertz? And so, yes, so refresh rate is no longer locked at 60 hertz. And instead, the display will refresh at pace with the graphics card. And they've developed a chip to go into monitors to control this, like several years of engineering effort. It's coming out in an ASUS monitor in January, although you can just buy it right now. Like a couple resellers have them now, so you can buy one. I'm sure they're going to show off more monitors at CES, and at some point you'll be able to buy this chip to install yourself if you have a specific monitor that supports it. I think a lot of the gaming-oriented panels in 2014 will probably start offering G-Sync options or switch to G-Sync or something like that.
All right, Jeremy?
Well, I don't know. It's more of a hope. I'm just going to say hope, because maybe it'll happen. But that
be optimistic.
John Carmack is not doing hardware engineering. He's doing software engineering for Oculus, and he will be making the killer app.
Oh, that's a good one. Oh gosh, I had one and then I lost it. Prediction.
I want to talk about the John Carmack a little bit more,
because okay, yeah.
I think when he signed on to split his time between id and Oculus, there's no way he was doing game software stuff. He was just there to work on the hardware and maybe like firmware and software for Oculus. But now that he has totally severed ties with id due to some stuff that he alluded to being pretty fucked up, like at the company, he's like, someday the whole story will come out of what has happened at id the last few years. I think there is definitely potential now for him to be there working on hardware for a while and then be like, I sure miss making games, and do some game software too.
Masters of Doom Part 2.
Yeah, gotta get Romero doing something.
Like, have you been on Romero's website?
No.
I saw Doom had its 20th anniversary.
Yeah, that's right.
This we didn't talk about that. That was a huge thing, and there was a great Metafilter thread about it, and great links to all the, like, Doom. There's still a big Doom community out there, and great Doom mods and versions, and the source has obviously been out for a while. But one of the links led me to John Romero's website, and it's made me think about, oh, where's that guy? What is that guy doing these days? And nothing lasts forever. Ozymandias.
What's your John Romero prediction for 2014?
I don't have a John Romero prediction for 2014. Not without incurring some libel. I think the Steam controller is going to be a dud.
Wow.
And that's me hedging and hoping I'm wrong, but I think it's going to be a dud.
Ah, too early to say, man.
I know it is. Absolutely too early to say. And that's why it's a prediction.
You never see early hardware released to the media like you are with this. And if you did, say so many things would be a dud. So I'm hoping.
I hope along with you. Highest of hopes.
Given the 300 people that they have and all the developers, that they will figure out how to utilize that controller.
What I mean by that is that it will fail in its attempt to replicate the keyboard mouse experience that PC gamers want in the living room, while at the same time, it might be, I don't know if it's going to be an improvement on two thumbstick controllers that console gamers love, but I think that it's not going to satisfy everyone.
One of the programmers for Super Meat Boy wrote a pretty good he liked it pretty well.
Did he?
He wrote a thing on Gamasutra about using it. And said initially he kind of talked about how sensitive he was to latency and how like he felt like the thing was laggy until they went into the TV and turned the game mode on because the display was laggy. It was like a plasma or LCD or whatever. He said he thought the clicking for using like as a button substitute, clicking on the thumb pads, that was fine. He thought that they should add little nubs to the directions on the touch pads just so you get kind of that specific, like, this is up, this is left, mm-hmm. and so on. And he said that in the end, he would use the 360 pad over the Steam pad due to familiarity, but that he was able to basically pull off everything he could do in Super Meat Boy on a regular controller with this one. He thought it was pretty good.
Wes?
Some big shit's going to go down at Microsoft next year, which is pretty vague, but they're going to have the big CEO changeover, and I think we'll see some major changes in direction, either for Windows or for Xbox, maybe both.
Is there a chance that Xbox might go away as a Microsoft division?
And get spun out into something separate? I don't think that'll happen.
Jeremy? That was a pretty weak prediction, by the way. I'm sorry.
I'm going to say that the Apple Watch will precede the Apple TV.
Wearables.
It just seems like I've been hearing that rumor at least just as long.
What's the cool feature and outside of the logo that's going to make you want to buy the Apple Watch?
I don't think it's anything more than the Pebble. It'll just be well-designed. It'll be smaller, have a nicer screen, and it'll interface completely with iOS. So you'll be able to get your everything that you don't have to have your phone on your hand. That easy. I don't think the battery life is going to be great, but I just think it'll be out before the Apple TV.
All right.
So two new hardwares from Apple, I guess that's an interesting prediction.
I don't know where Apple can go with the iPhone and the iPad.
Yeah.
Bigger
phone.
No, thinner. Thinner, lighter. I think robots are going to be big next year.
Come on, that's shittier than my prediction.
That is shittier than prediction. I got to think of a good one. What company won't exist next year? I think last year we said BlackBerry wouldn't exist by this time. It's still around. I think BlackBerry, that's also pretty easy. Something bolder. What's going to go away? I don't know.
Boulder is usually just stupider.
I think this is running out of steam.
Fair enough. It turns out predictions are difficult. If you have your own prediction for what's going to come in the world of tech, science, entertainment, and culture in 2014, we all know I'm first in line to see Fast 7 whenever they finish that. I saw Fast 6. Loved it.
Digital Paul Walker.
With his brother.
Paul Walker will be the first fully digital actor in a film.
Simulation 1.
I predict tested premium content will be a huge success in 2014.
Oh, thank you, Jeremy. I apologize to those watching now who remembers that we haven't had the output that we've wanted because a third of us are on vacation right now and we're still working out our video player and stuff. But a lot of ideas. I have some fun ideas for tested premium content. We'll be doing a bunch of stuff at CES also. But that will, I think, wrap it up for 2013. This is only a test. We had a successful Octobercast. We've done some pretty amazing things this year. I can go month by month.
You went to the LHC.
That
was this year.
That was this year. I was going to say NASA. We went to NASA. We met David Chang, one of the best chefs in America. Went to the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland. We built a Halo Needler, or had that project on the site. What other amazing things have we done this year?
You ate hot peppers on a 24-hour podcast?
We ate hot peppers. We did a successful...
And it didn't kill you?
But that's a memory that I can actually go back to it and tap into that feeling of how hot that felt. Now I know. I can't even, I don't remember what else happened this year. I'm trying to look at the wall and everything. That was all last year. Went to New York, Maker Faire. Went to Dragon Con for the first time. Had an incredibly successful Comic Con. And we'll get to do it all again in 2014. Hopefully along with you guys. Thanks so much for listening to our podcast and for watching our silly videos and for reading the stuff we have on Tesla.com. I hope I can speak for the regular crew, Will and Gary, in thanking everyone for watching. And we'll be around for a lot longer. We have merch also, new Tesla t-shirts in the store right now. Thanks, Wes, and thanks, Jeremy, for being closers and being clutch on our last minute podcast.
My pleasure.
Wanted to have one before the end of the year. We'll see you next year. No fake outtakes because we're running super long. But see you guys in 2014. Bye.
Hi there. I didn't see you. Tested. I like fruit and I like being a ninja, and this game is for me because it's called Fruit Ninja.